Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
Spent some of the morning watching C-SPAN and Rand Paul grilling Hillary Clinton, pointing out that if he was the president, he would have relieved her of her position. And we have that clip coming up. And that's the point. You know, when, quote, government screwed up in the past or in any other country for that matter, the people responsible for it resign or go to jail. But nowadays, the answer is give us more funding, and that's what Hillary Clinton said. That's why whenever FEMA ordered the police to stand down during Katrina on Bush's watch, FEMA then got even more funding, saying, we need more power. They've engineered that into the system. It's just an amazing level of corruption. But you see, watching the Senate hearings with Hillary, only part of it is being covered. Because our government armed the Libyan al-Qaeda rebels out of Saudi Arabia, who first came from Saudi Arabia and other countries, into Benghazi 2 years ago to destabilize and take down Libya. They were on the BBC saying, next stop, Damascus, Syria. They've been there. They've been given heat-seeking missiles. Some numbers are as high as 15,000. Most numbers are around 12,000. 10,000 of those heat seekers, pretty high tech. Take down any jet airliner you want. They've been attacking jet airliners, shooting them up. Passenger liners. And then the media thinks you're so stupid. They go, we have to give our rights up and invade all over Africa and Algeria and Mali because Al-Qaeda's there. And then our criminal occupied government uses that as a pretext with NATO and France to invade Mali and Algeria and other areas. I mean, it's amazing. We predicted 4 years ago in the Obama deception they would use Al-Qaeda that they control to invade all over Africa because we know how they operate, and we saw the buildup of AFRICOM. So the truth is 100% in plain view, but it's so over the top, everyone would have to say, you're right, Alex, we apologize. The globalists who've hijacked our country run Al-Qaeda. And the media spins that and says, you're saying George W. Bush had a plunger at the World Trade Center. You're saying everybody in the government, the guy that delivers letters to your post office box, he's behind it. That's the games they play. No, criminal globalist cartel elements infiltrating the CIA, FBI, NSA, the National Security Council. They finance the politicians that get into power, the foreign banks. They have put their people in, and they're using Al-Qaeda to destabilize and overthrow governments or attack Western governments as a pretext for the Western government to then crack down on the general population. I've been saying that for 11 years, and now it's all public. Oh, don't worry about Al-Qaeda. This is now for the general public. So we're going to be breaking all of that down today. And then there's articles like this out of CNS News. Former Special Forces Commander, top general, was U.S. running guns to Syrian rebels via Benghazi. CIA says no. General Boykin goes on to say that the evidence points towards them doing this. Well, the evidence doesn't point towards it. It's on record that our government, NATO, all run by the mega banks, on record, brought Al-Qaeda into Libya, then brought them into Syria, invaded from three different countries, and have had Turkish artillery backing them up, and CIA commandos and British commandos and Saudi Arabian commandos in there helping attack over the last 20-plus months Syria. I mean, it's the Turkish ambassador was there, the missile cache was there, there was some double cross, or they wanted to get rid of the witness to it, and they killed the ambassador in order to stand down for 8 hours. And the people they used to kill him, the Al-Qaeda forces, were the U.S.-certified, NATO-certified security for Benghazi. Okay, that's what happened. Open and shut. Period. Done. And the whole government knows it. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. It is the 23rd day of January 2013 on this Wednesday edition. Coming up at the bottom of the hour, because we're tracking it live right now, we'll give you the latest on Hillary Clinton's testimony to the Senate committee, Rand Paul to Hillary Clinton. If I were a president, I would have relieved you of your post. We're going to be going over that. Former Special Forces Commander, retired General William G. Boykin, who literally was at the heart of the CIA and black operations, is saying that he believes that they were funding and giving missiles and weapons to Al-Qaeda-based Syrian rebels. Well, I mean, that's not even debatable. That's like saying, I believe the sun came up this morning. I mean, it's New York Times, Associated Press, LA Times, in the last 6 months, Council on Foreign Relations. We told you about it 22 months ago when the whole thing started. It's a plan to turn the entire Middle East over to Wahhabist Al-Qaeda, run by Saudi Arabia, itself run by the megabanks. So at the bottom of the hour, I'll do a special report on that and give you the latest. In fact, we have a skeleton crew today. One of our guys is out taking care of a sick child. It's in yesterday's stack. Can you guys repull the London Independent and a couple others where the Prime Minister of Algeria is saying, you know, the West is behind these staged terror attacks as a pretext to invade our countries? There's guys with blonde hair and blue eyes attacking our facilities. And then they pull out, and then the West gets to come in. See, I've seen this over and over again. Operation Gladio, Ajax, Tonkin, staging events or even having real attacks. Northwoods talks about shooting up Americans in, you know, in shopping malls and movie theaters and on the streets. Declassified in 2000, September 2000. And the plan was killed by President Kennedy, but later given a new name and engaged in that. That's why we have to say, could these events be staged? And then when they have the telltale signs, then it moves into, it's a probability they are. Especially Colorado. I mean, that is cartoon level, where he's getting DARPA funding and mind control. He's got a top Air Force psychiatrist who'd been the head of whole operations at entire bases in San Antonio. Over him, meeting with him multiple times a week. They're talking about national security, and the police don't want it released his workbook with her, where he reportedly was planning to do all this. You want me to keep going? Witnesses of multiple shooters, all the rest of it. Him in the jail saying, I don't remember who I am, obviously drugged out of his mind. I mean, we already knew this, but it came out in the LA Times that Theodore Kaczynski, the Unabomber, was under CIA mind control, and it was declassified that he had been in a volunteer to MKUltra and had disappeared into the program for close to 30 years. He entered it in the mid-60s as a PhD student, disappears for decades, and starts bombing prominent scientists and people. And his letters are how we've got to exterminate the majority of humanity or they're going to destroy the earth, but the elite are planning to kill us anyways, so we've got to stop that. I mean, what is this? And the media's like, Alex Jones thinks it's mind control. No such thing. I mean, they probably had more than 30 mainstream articles, Daily Beast, you name it, Time Magazine, saying for some reason Jones went and watched Batman and found Sandy Hook in it. And now says it's behind it. No. We said before Batman came out that from analyzing it and the previous franchise, it is a film full of psychological triggers. And then the movie comes out and Sandy Hook's in it. And then we find out hundreds of media people were mailed Bane command charts showing the mass terror attack points like Sandy Hook and others. They're like, well, this is bizarre. I know it's bizarre. This is the gang signs the globalists also use to communicate with each other. I don't believe in all this. They do. I don't go to Bohemian Grove and worship a big owl. You know, I'm not Jimmy Savile, the top royal confidant, who it turns out is a Satanist and a mass child molester, running big children's charities and hanging out and having keys and the highest national security clearances into the royal family and bragging I supply them things, and they've declared national security on that. They just declared national security on him, quote, supplying things. He'd publicly brag at elite parties with the prime ministers and the queen and Prince Charles and all of them, and the guy is a devil-worshipping pedophile. And by the way, I've analyzed that the main banking structure is moving to Frankfurt, Germany. This is high-level blackmail by the European Illuminati against the British Empire. High-level wars going on. That's why this is being released now that he's dead. This has been known for decades at the BBC where he worked. And they're now going, you're going to do what we say. We're going to run the New World Order. Because the Skeksis are all battling over the throne right now. The New World Order is almost complete. It's entering the endgame. And now they're going to start battling over who gets the throne. Who gets the ring of Mordor, of Morgoth. And you wonder why everything they do is so diabolical and so twisted and so evil and so sick and so filthy. I mean, if you're a new listener and you're like, well, who's Jimmy Savile? Well, who's Jerry Sandusky? Raping children in front of people at high noon in a field house, which is like the main entrance of an airport. You've never been inside a field house. I mean, it's people coming and going constantly, even at night, especially at a college. And then, of course, it came out higher. The whole top of the university was covering it up. Of course, he was just the procurer of the children. And you're like, man, Alex, why are you telling us this? Because they're monsters. That's why. You don't get into the club with these people unless you are very, 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 very sick. Again, I've talked a lot about this because he wrote about it. Hitler loved to go to the front in Poland and France and then with Russia until they started getting beaten. Then he pulled back to the wolf's lair, the wolf's den, his forest bunkers. And he would sit there with big telescopes from 10 miles away, but with a big telescope, crystal clear, watching people getting killed, watching things burn, watching people jumping out of tall windows. And they say he would stay up sometimes for days taking amphetamines and eating pastry after pastry. He could not draw himself away from watching his bombers bomb and burn major cities. And he just described it as absolutely beautiful. And so you need to figure out, folks, if you don't tie government down with the chains of the Bill of Rights and Constitution, if you don't put government on a very short leash, it will put you on one. And I just went off into, and I'll cover it at the bottom of the hour after I get to Nightline at the bottom of the hour. I heard that last week, but then I was leaving town Thursday night to go out to the desert to do some hiking with my son and others. And would have brought my daughters. They're too little to hike 4 miles up a mountain. I'm surprised he did it. He did a pretty good job. We were ready to turn back anytime he wanted to, but he said he wanted to go to the top. And Rob Deuce, son, who's even younger, climbed it too. But so I heard you had Nightline did a piece on you, and I just figured it would be the piece they did 2.5 years ago. And it is the old piece, but they added some new stuff to it. And it's another window into the mindset of these guys, because in the piece coming up, and I'm going to recap this, you'll notice that he says, first you guys said there wasn't a world government. And now you're just saying, well, it's not a bad world government. And he goes, I'm not even saying there is a world government. Like what he says is what makes reality. Like when your child tells you, I didn't drink milk out of the jug and you got a mustache. I just saw you do it. Don't lie to me. And it's the same thing. And I say, that's why you're discredited. See, what you don't know is 30 minutes before they wanted to go shoot outside at a local park, 30 minutes before, we're in my office, right in out there with a bunch of clips lined up of world leaders describing world government, congressional record on world government, CFR quotes, where they said it, what bi-monthly foreign affairs journal they said it. And I had it all for him, and he watched a few clips, and he goes, well, that's a different world government. That's a good world government, not the world government you're talking about. So 30 minutes later, I'm out there at a park where they want to do a different part of the interview, and I go, first you say there's no world government, now you're saying it's not a bad world government, it's a different world government. He goes, no, I'm not even agreeing there is that there is one. And that's why I say, that's why you're discredited. But people watching that, see, I'm talking to him like he's a real person. And then he said, I went to dinner with him and I was nice, so that discredits me because I'm not this wild man in person. I was trying as a human to communicate with them because the guy's the host of ABC Nightly News. And that's still got 4 or 5 million viewers a night. That's still got some of the big old numbers of Dinosaur Media, one of the only bastions of it. Nightline, you know, has got 2 or 3 million. And I'm sitting there, and then they use that in the piece, like, behind the scenes, he was nice. And look, here he is throwing a football, and he doesn't know anybody's watching. And if my memory serves, they go, what's this football? Oh, you play football like that was bad. I go, yeah, with my son. And we're like, oh, here, let's toss it. I mean, they knew that that was being videotaped. They imply that I was secretly throwing a football. I mean, it's bizarre.
Looking back on 2012, we ask ourselves,
the globalists see us as animals, programmable animals. And it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. When the whole society gets designed the lowest common denominator, and when the system honors people that are subservient and go along to get along, it creates a perfect environment for the pathogen of very despotic, megalomaniacal tyranny and tyrants to take control. And that's history. And that's what's so frustrating, is that I sat there this morning for about an hour playing with my 4-year-old daughter and playing with the stuffed animals and playing with the My Little Pony and playing hide and go seek. And I sat there while she was in her room after about an hour of playing with her, and I was going to have to tell her I had to go. I knew she was going to beg me not to leave. And I just thought, how do I take this stillness, this understanding that I have right now of how the world works, and this deep sorrow and pain that is such a strength, and how do I transmit that and decipher that and encode that in words so that the general public can understand what I'm saying? But I know that by saying that, fathers and mothers and grandmothers and grandfathers and brothers and sisters and sons and daughters, once the man, twice the child, taking care of their parents, you know what I'm talking about, that all I want to do is protect her. All I want to do is have a good world for her. All I want to do is lift up others so that she can commune with them and her grandchildren with their grandchildren and their grandchildren with their great-great-grandchildren. And it hurts me to my core that humanity may not make it. We may not get to the point of a type 1 civilization, meaning we could survive if this planet was destroyed, and the incredible destiny that God has for us. If we don't stand up and do the right thing, God gave us a brain, God gave us a soul, a heart, and the power of his image as creators to build amazing things. And I know how great humanity is. And I can't imagine the world we would be in if the leaders of this planet were actually trying to empower humanity. Oh, they claim all day that their mission is to empower people. They claim all day. I watched clips. I'd already seen them, but I watched a compilation at about 7 a.m. this morning of Joe Biden. We have it. If we have time later, we're going to play it. Of Joe Biden, with relish, I mean, when you have discernment, it's not even discernment, anybody would see it. The relish he has when he talks about these beautiful children, shawl shot up, just riddled with holes, riddled with holes. And he's clearly using it, pressing on the wound, putting salt in the wound, feeding off of it. I know his history. I know his background. I know how evil he is. I know how he works to deindustrialize America. I know how bad these guys are. I know their mindset, their code. And he's sitting there just sticking his finger in the wound like a bullet hole. And you say, oh, I know it hurts. We finally, the image of these four-year-olds, aren't even four, all shot up full of bullet holes. This with the parents, we're going to get this done. And I realize they got drones killing, you know, in one country alone last year, 200-plus kids, Pakistan. You know, just saying all collateral damage and putting Al-Qaeda in Libya and Syria, 40,000 dead at least, lining up blacks, videos of black men, women, and children with Al-Qaeda with because it's cheaper to use machetes, and plus they have more fun doing it, just hacking them up, just hacking their noses off, hacking their arms as they beg an arm. I mean, stuff we won't even show you. It's on YouTube. They try to take it down as fast as they can. Taking Christians and throwing them off five-story buildings and chopping their heads off and celebrating and saying, we're going to destroy America, Allah Akbar, 9/11, we're coming, we've got the missiles, we're going to kill you next. And our government, foreign banks, that's who they are, the occupiers, are doing this. And then I go and TSA wants me to take my shoes off and grope me to see if I'm Al-Qaeda. I mean, I'm like, look, game over, joke over, scam over. No, 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 no. And I realize why I blew up at Piers Morgan. I am physically angry. And not even in a hate level. It's more of just the anger of trying to burst through a foot of ice that you're trapped under. You know, if you fall through a frozen lake, I mean, it's that kind of anger. I want out of here. I don't like this. Get off my back. It's that feeling where two or three bullies are beating you up, and they get you down, and they got you tackled, and you get beyond mad. You go, these people aren't going to be on me in a minute. And you just decide to get up and stomp them. It's that kind of feeling. Like, I don't care anymore what happens to me. You people want to abuse children. You're a bunch of sick filth, and I will not stand here and watch you like ghouls use those little kids' deaths to disarm the American people. By the way, Australia took everything but single shot, bolt action. They're now set to ban those. It's always the same story. We'll be back.
We're on the march.
Coming up, we're going to break down what happened and what's still ongoing with the Benghazi whitewash hearings that are going on in Congress right now. And sure, Rand Paul said, I would have relieved you of your position when you did this. From what I saw and what I'm tracking at Infowars.com and sites like DrudgeReport.com is really on top of it. They're not bringing up, hey, why did our government use Al-Qaeda to overthrow Libya to begin with? I mean, it's on record that NATO is arming them. And our military is the heart of NATO. So we need to be honest with ourselves about this, because if all this information is forced out there into the general consciousness and general awareness, it's game over. The establishment thinks you're so unconscious, so stupid. They're using real Al-Qaeda out of Saudi Arabia, Qatar, and other countries, brought in over 2 years ago to Libya to start a almost year-long civil war with air raids and bombings of major cities and laying waste to whole neighborhoods. And it was called humanitarian because Obama is a Peace Prize winner. Just amazing. And then they used that same group and publicly exported them to Turkey, Jordan, and other areas to have them infiltrate the country publicly and attack. And they've got, this has been admitted for over a year in mainstream media, but it's back in the newspaper, that Western commandos are advising them and training them. I mean, they're at U.S. bases in Turkey right on the border. And then the Syrians battle back against them. And so they open up for a few weeks with artillery to clear the area to send in the jihadis. And then I've seen some conservatives go, well, good, we got Arabs killing Arabs. Man, that's some bad karma right there. I don't mean karma in the Indian fashion, but you reap what you sow. What comes around goes around. I mean, really? That kind of so-called conservative is not a conservative. They are a fascistic, warped, dehumanizing person who has visions of power and reflected glory by smart bombs and artillery. I bet you $1 million if you took one of those so-called good old boys, because most of them aren't really good old boys, and you stuck a gun in their hand and lined up 10 little Afghan kids with snot coming out their nose or little eyes looking up at you, so ignorant that most of them can't even find the U.S. on a map. I mean, these are like cavemen. I bet you those people would not have the nerve to pull the trigger on one of those kids, much less all 10 of them. And if they did, they'd be basket cases and commit suicide later, like our troops do, by the way. You're not meant to go and kill a bunch of innocent kids. Your body, unless you're a full-born psychopath, genetically, if you're not totally evil and totally given over to evil from birth, doing evil things like that will destroy you. You will destroy yourself. Your body will hit the self-destruct switch. When you do good, you feel empowered, and the universe opens up to you. When you do evil, you destroy yourself. That's a universal law. You don't have to even believe in God to know that that's the case. And our military men and women, most of them got in because they were poor, or they had military background families, or they genuinely cared about society and wanted to help. A small percentage, they become the contractors in a lot of cases, enjoy psychopathic killing. It's a place where they can go out and kill and get paid to do it. And they believe it's manly. It might be manly if you've got to fight for your tribe to fight other men. But it is not manly to be like basically aliens from another planet with incredibly super high-tech weapons to come into Stone Age areas with people that don't even know who you are or where your country is. They've done studies who will fight you just because they're still humans. They're primitive humans, but they still have their human programming of there are invaders, I better fight them, which is what any group of humans has always done. And the globalists hire a bunch of Muslim terrorists to stage attacks, to carry out real attacks, or to take the blame for attacks, to attack the West so they can take all of our liberties. And I'm already getting into Benghazi now. We got two big guests today. We have Dr. Jim Garrow, who's run the program to save 30-plus thousand Chinese girls. He's been nominated for the Nobel Prize. He says he's talked to a top military retired officer who told him that Obama is doing a litmus test, will you fire on U.S. citizens? Now, I believe he talked to this person, they told him that, and the article we wrote about it adds the fact that they're buying 1.6 billion bullets, armored vehicles, and the new army manuals since 2010 say, train them to cordon cities, confiscate guns, and shoot Americans. I can play you ABC Nightly News in Katrina with the army officer saying, if you don't turn your guns in, we kill Americans. And by the way, a lot of that went on. You know, it's the same ABC piece where the police chief says, all the guns will be taken, no one will be allowed to be armed. You just type in gun confiscation, New Orleans, there's NRA videos with millions of views on YouTube. If you're a new listener, I'm not going to play it again. I've probably played it 100 times in the last 6-7 years since Katrina. I'm not playing it again. You know it's there. I mean, for a couple of weeks, people denied gun confiscation was even happening. So he's going to be joining us. And then the main host of the Young Turks, Sink, is going to be coming on the broadcast. We look forward to that for a lively discussion. And if we have time while he's on, Melissa Melton, I told her, one of our reporters and researchers, she actually in college, part of her degree is stats. So I said, listen, I just guesstimated off these FBI numbers, 49% and 21% drop in overall violent crime and gun crime. So I had her spend the last couple of days breaking it down at FBI.gov. She's trying to export the video right now for radio listeners. We'll post it on InfoWars, where we can show you that indeed my mental math was correct. Of course, I also saw them flash the numbers on Fox News and went and double-checked it. They didn't even show the graphs. We're going to show all those off FBI.gov. 49% drop. And I was wrong. I misunderstood it when I saw it on Fox, when I looked at the numbers myself. They just showed numbers. It's 49 in violent crime total in the last 20 years, since 1991, because the numbers are always about a year behind. Last numbers we have is 11, so they say since 1991. And then we have the other numbers. It's even higher. Illegal acts with guns has gone on even more, because America's swimming in guns. Criminals have got their heads down. They go into immigrant areas where they know people aren't armed. You know, the Chinese triads go and feed on the Chinese immigrants they know don't have a gun culture. The Mexican mafia goes and feeds on the poor Mexicans they know most of them don't have guns. Chicago, New York, where the guns have been taken, the criminals go and feed on you and your family. I mean, criminals do not do home invasions. It's like 100, I was looking at the numbers. It was over 100 times more common in Chicago than, say, in a small town in West Texas or even a big city like Dallas. I mean, they don't home invade while you're there. They make sure you're not there, and then they still don't. Because, I mean, every day I read in the back of the paper where people kill somebody in their house. And these criminals are so dumb. The ones that are dumb enough to enter a house, they'll be like, stop, I have a gun, and they keep coming with the machete or whatever. And they're always whacked out on drugs and they die. The criminals are on the run. And that's why they're big overlord criminals, the big daddy criminals, like Chicago mob boss, the Godfather, as he's called, Emmanuel and Obama, their instinct is don't hurt our criminal brethren. And they want the fear. They want the locked doors. They want you to have to call for more police, which they then hire their own criminals to beat. And then dominate you. They don't like the fact that most police are awake now. They don't like the fact that most forces aren't corrupt in the country. They want to convert us to a mafia system where they're above the law and safe. And our gun culture is winning and taking over. Even Clinton said this last week. I'm yet to play the video, but it was up at Infowars.com. So they understand this is a desperate gamble for them. They've got to kill the gun culture now because it's cancer to them. It's growing. This is a big surgery. They don't know if they're going to make it. They're in their doctor. Can we cut out the Constitution? Rangel said it's our ultimate goal to get over the Constitution and Southerners. I love how they try to say it's Southerners that want guns. Folks, it's people all over this country want guns. I just saw a Tiananmen Square video from one of the hundreds of gun rallies of people with guns at the Capitols, loaded in many cases, exercising the right. See, the system can't stand that. They want to shame you and act like guns are already illegal. So when the carpet cleaner's at your house, they call the cops on you. That's what these new laws they're proposing and new executive orders say, is that if someone feels threatened by a gun at your house, go ahead and call the cops. They'll go ahead and take your guns, and then they'll make you go to a psychological evaluation. And they say just wanting guns is a sign of mental illness, or not trusting government. Well, then America was founded on mental illness. And then we just got all the wealth and all the power because we had the liberty. I guess mental illness, you know what? If that's crazy, throw me in there. Okay? You're right. You control freak criminals. I absolutely hate you and know who you are, and I want nothing to do with you. And if you call that crazy, you bet I am. I'm as crazy as the day is long. You bet. Now let's go to this piece. This is Nightline. And this was 2.5 years ago they came here. And you notice they don't even say, at least on the version I saw, and point out this is 2.5 years old. It's like, we went and talked to Alex. And then they cut in the Piers Morgan appearance. And at the end they say, he'll now be under a lot of scrutiny, implying it was evil for me to say I have 50 guns. That was just a guesstimation. As if, oh my gosh, he's dangerous. And then they show me throwing the football. And then they imply, oh, he's not always this crazy in person. It's all an act. Because there's a football in the back of the car, and we're getting in it. They're like, oh, you got a football. What's that? Oh, you relax. I go, well, yeah, of course I do. I have children. It's my son's football. And I'm like, here, you want to catch it? And they cut it in going, when he didn't know the camera was rolling, he was playing football. That's not true. And then they say, he talked about many things with us not related to the New World Order. Talked about their family, stuff like that, went to dinner with them. I've told that story. But the point is, well, let's go ahead and start the piece. Here is Nightline, you know, implying I take bits and pieces. Here's that clip.
We begin with America and its guns. As President Obama prepares to announce his sweeping plan to curb gun violence tomorrow.
Hit pause.
Across the country.
Back to the start. I've got to just analyze the whole thing. I'm sorry. It'll take a few segments. Talk about a woman who loves the sound of her voice. America's guns. President Obama. It's like some kind of weird, like, confidence game. These people are a joke. Reading off her teleprompter. And then they cut to the host of ABC Nightly News who came down here. And again, listen to this. And then they say, hey, that CNN piece about one-child policies, that was tongue-in-cheeky. Jokey. And you read the article, no, it wasn't. They just sell turn. You're like, yeah, drones are killing people. It's real cool. Ah, yeah. Yeah, we're setting up checkpoints on the highway to take blood. Ah, see, it's all done. Ah, that's part of their psych warfare. Everything's fine, see? Let's go back to the clip. Here it is.
We begin with America and its guns as President Obama prepares to announce his sweeping plan to curb gun violence tomorrow. Across the country, millions have already rushed out to buy a record number of new guns. And one man who thinks that's a very good thing, radio shock jock Alex Jones. He made national headlines last week with a fiery pro-gun tirade that quickly...
Back it up a few seconds. Thank you. I'm a shock jock because, I mean, I think it's shocking that Rangel says we've got to overcome the Constitution and that Southerners are just bad people, period. I mean, wow. Imagine if you said Northeasterners, they're trash. I mean, it's ridiculous. And the Constitution's bad. I mean, Australian gun grabbers target bolt-action rifles. They always take the semi-autos first, then the handguns, then the pistols, then the bolt-actions, then the single shot. They want all guns turned in. We knew that was coming. They do that everywhere. This is how they do it. See, I find that shocking. I find it shocking that they pass the NDAA to secretly arrest and kill and disappear U.S. citizens. I find it shocking that megabanks have been caught laundering hundreds of billions of dollars of drug money and don't get in trouble. But see, I'm a shock jock because I'm here going, wake up, America. We're going into tyranny. But they just want you to be easy and cool and go watch a sitcom, have a martini. Hey, man, everything's fine. I'm here to get you out of your coma. You see, that's why it was so shocking. They thought I was going to come on and debate the First Amendment and should he be deported, and they wanted talking points, and we're going to stick to this, aren't we? And he had Alan Dershowitz ready in the next segment. I went off the script, folks. It wasn't, oh, they got me on there because they knew I'd blow up. They picked that up and broadcast that everywhere before they realized, oh, wait a minute, this is actually waking people up, which it did, see. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. Let's go back to Nightline with a recycled, re-edited piece. Here it is.
Headlines last week with a fiery pro-gun tirade that quickly went viral. And that's not all he's got to say. Here's ABC's Dan Harris.
Are you for Hitler or against Hitler? Whatever they say, it's the opposite.
Let's hit pause.
They never tell.
Let's just back it up. I mean, what does that even mean? My point was, you're either for Stalin or against Stalin. You're either for Hitler or against Hitler. You're either against this new world order and all this tyranny, or you know, you're either for it or you're against it. It's very simple. But they just have a thing about Hitler. So people go, oh, Hitler. I saw a piece David Knight did. It was one of the crew about Martin Luther King. It was Mike Adams. Martin Luther King and how he wouldn't support Obama. And I saw people commenting in there and they were serious. They go, are they bashing Martin Luther King in this piece? Because at the end, Mike Adams says America doesn't want kings anymore. And we're talking about King George III and we don't want King Obama. And then people thought it was code against Martin Luther King. I mean, whoa. New World Order is coming down on people at a million miles an hour and people are looking for codes. But I'm going to shut up, though, because we're going to break here in a minute and a half. Let's start with this clip. Here it is.
Are you for Hitler or against Hitler? Whatever they say, it's the opposite. They never tell the truth.
Tonight, as millions of Americans worry about the government taking away their guns, this man, Alex Jones, is pushing a lot of buttons.
And I'm here to tell you, 1776 will commence again if you try to take our firearms. We will not relinquish them. Do you understand? The Republic will rise again when you attempt to take our guns.
When Jones went on CNN's Piers Morgan tonight,
Alex,
why'd our government ship guns into Mexico?
Alex,
to discuss gun control in the wake of the Sandy Hook massacre.
You're a hatchet man of the New World Order.
He created a sensation. This video went massively viral.
And I want to say this right here. You think you're a tough guy? Have me back with a boxing ring in here.
But who is Alex Jones?
We've got ABC Nightly News / Nightline here.
Despite his mistrust of the so-called mainstream media, Jones agreed to let us into his world for a day.
Hey, we're just soldiers looking across each other on the picket line here.
America has been captured. America is being robbed. We are now being looted like a third world nation. Well, I'm not going to sit down and shut up.
Jones is arguably the nation's premier purveyor of what could be called paranoia porn.
All right, pause. Deception. Yeah, we were paranoid porn pushers when we said they were going to come for your guns. We were paranoid porn pushers when we said that they would raise taxes on poor people, which they've now done. We were paranoid porn pushers when we said foreign countries would take their gold out of the U.S. It's all happening. All happening.
If you've ever wanted one of our best-selling generators, but we're waiting for...
Don't forget, ladies and gentlemen, this broadcast and our entire news organization is funded by American patriots like you, not by government or Rockefeller funds stolen from taxpayers like NPR and others. So be sure and buy the books, the videos, the new Come and Take It, best-selling T-shirt at InfoWarsStore.com. And be sure and get the best gravity-fed stainless steel filters out there at InfoWarsStore.com. ProPure, 10% off the already lowest price out there with the promo code WATER. InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsShop.com are linked through at PrisonPlanet.com or PrisonPlanet.tv right over to the shopping cart. And again, I want to thank everybody for their support out there. We could not do it without you, and also supporting our sponsors. We have some new skateboards. We got contacted. I shouldn't even talk about this yet, but the point is they're up there on the site. So I need to discuss that probably at another point. Great way to wake people up is to have skateboards with InfoWars.com and the Alien Workshop artwork on it. Okay, let's get back to the Nightline, and then I got to get into Benghazi after this guest comes on. And we got the head of the Young Turks coming on the broadcast here today, and a lot of other important economic news. But first, let's go ahead and go back to the Nightline piece. Here it is.
The truth strikes back.
I'm live in 30 seconds.
All right. Oh my God. Out of his studios near Austin, Texas, his radio show and webcast reach an estimated 1 million people a day.
3 million.
This federal intrusion is out of control.
And on YouTube and elsewhere, Jones estimates 200 million people have seen his various
documentaries. No, that's one YouTube channel.
We're taking our destiny back. You're not our gods or our masters.
With titles like The Fall of the Republic, Endgame, Blueprint for Global Enslavement, and The Obama Deception. Do you actually believe everything you say?
I believe all of it, absolutely. What I'm telling is the truth.
None of it is, you know, a shtick, a show at all?
No, it's all true.
You think Obama's a criminal?
Barack Obama is definitely an unconstitutional criminal.
Jones espouses a litany of conspiracy theories, although he thinks that term belittles his reporting. FEMA's running concentration camps?
Setting them up.
They have designated sports stadiums. They have designated fields for the American
people. The manuals are public. I gave them to him.
The government's poisoning the water?
Absolutely. I have all these other government documents where the government...
Hit pause. And again, I sat there and showed them the book, showed them the quotes, showed them the plans, and they didn't want to look at it. So they cut all that out when I'm giving proof. Just, this guy's crazy. Next, he's going to say they injected black people with syphilis. Oh, they did that. Next, they're going to say that a bunch of kids just got paralyzed again from the Bill Gates meningitis shots. Oh, never mind. Next, they'll say they radiated the troops and killed a bunch of them. Oh, they did that. Next, they'll say they sterilized 500,000 women without their consent. Oh, they did that. Next, they're going to say that the troops were exposed to sarin gas and it got covered up in the Gulf War. And tens of thousands died. Oh, that happened? Let's go back to it. Here it is.
Government think tanks propose poisoning the water to dumb down the population, make them more easily manageable.
9/11 was an inside job?
Yes, 9/11 was an inside job. It was a staged event to launch the Iraq war and to set up a domestic police state here in the United States.
All I'm calling for is a real investigation, and the people of Oklahoma City have been calling for an investigation.
Jones, who's 38, got his start with a local cable access show in the 1990s. He now has a huge fan base, which at various times has included celebrities like Willie Nelson, Jesse Ventura, Charlie Sheen.
We want our country back, Mr. President. I'm calling on each and every American citizen to wake up, stand up, and demand the truth.
And reality stars Spencer Pratt and Heidi Montag.
Spencer Pratt, good to have you on with us today.
Thank you so much. I'm so honored to be on with you. You are a true legend,
all right,
a true man.
That's enough. The whole video is online. It's called The Return of Alex Jones. I didn't have time to get to it where I'm throwing the football. We'll have to play it later. It's like, oh, this is secret footage of him throwing a football. I mean, it's just unbelievable hit piece. Earlier in the last hour, I said our guest has saved 35,000. That was an old number. It's 45,000 Chinese girls. They estimate there's something like 20-something million more men in China last time I saw. May even be higher. Than there are women, because they're killing the young women. It's supposed to be about 51% women women live a little bit longer, so that goes into the actuary, but also there's slightly more, if you do international studies, baby girls born than baby boys. Kind of something God designed in there, so there's more women out there, so we can have a leg up as a mammalian species. But that's a side issue. Again, Alex Jones here. Thanks for joining us. Dr. James Garrow, PhD, well-known, I've heard of him many times, Canadian teacher and businessman who founded a big institute in China back in the 60s, discovered how they were killing the children with the one-child policy, which is now on record. In fact, his work helped expose that. He's coming up in the next segment. Because he was told by a retired high-level military officer that the litmus test is, will you fire on U.S. citizens? And I just thought, I probably should have done more research, or not more research, more, that's not the word, because I've done the research. I should have done more pulling data and sources to show you here, because I can show you all the Army manuals where they're training for gun confiscation. I can show you all of that where they're training to shoot Americans. I mean, that's on the news now. So you understand, it's not just him talking to this source we're going to try to find out about. It's that it's already hiding in plain view. And the 1.6 billion bullets and the end of posse comitatus and the troops on the streets and all the rest of it, that's coming up in the next segment. He'll be with us for about 35, 40 minutes. And then I will get into Benghazi because that's very important. And I want to break down what's really behind that. I mentioned some of it last hour, but it's key. That's coming up. And then I'm seeing articles like this every two or three days. Actually, every day, really. Because every couple of days, I'll see two or three at one time. So I guess it's about every day. There's probably seven of these stories a week, I'd have to guesstimate. Elementary school girl threatened with arrest over paper gun. And, you know, you hear about people say, career day, write about your dad or mom. Well, my dad's in the Marines. You know, here's a picture of him with his M16. Boom, you're arrested. Taken in for psychiatric questioning as a 10-year-old. Doesn't matter, you're the star quarterback or whatever. You know, and I've never been in trouble. It's just crazy. Or you bring a Dixie plastic knife to spread butter your mother drops in the lunchbox. My mother did that. Boom, you're arrested. But government stomps around in Darth Vader outfits all day. Elementary school girl threatened with arrest over paper gun. Hysteria and aftermath of Sandy Hook reaches new heights. That's an Infowars.com article out of Philadelphia Elementary. Now, of course, in Philadelphia, it came out 5 years ago, they've got laptops they give you watching you at home. And they're the ones that announced that. They're very proud of it. We played the clips of the teachers doing interviews. That's how it broke, going, yeah, we watch you when you're at home. What you're doing, look out. Like they're Santa Claus, a demon clause or something. This is the total demonization of a boy's playing with an orange and green Nerf gun in his front yard with kids. SWAT team is called. The anti-gunners are so anti-gun, they say they don't believe boys should be able to play with guns. You hear about kids getting in trouble for making bang bang, you know, using their fingers as a gun. But the so-called leftists, who are really authoritarians, they want checkpoints, they want 1.6 billion bullets, they want armored vehicles, they want TSA hands on the pants, they want to bomb Benghazi and bomb Syria. They want to do all this. They love force. Bomb Belgrade, go after the Serbs, but that because it's loving when they do it. They love force. I mean, you know these people when they see an orange gun and kids running around a front yard, you see everywhere. You know that they know that's not a real gun when they see a six-year-old doing it and they call the police. It's like neighbors in Oklahoma saw the upstanding, you know, middle-class family's three-year-old pee up against a tree in the front yard. They came and they gave him a ticket and threatened him with arrest and stuff. And they fired that cop, and they should have. I mean, everybody knows that three-year-olds pee in the yard. But again, it's this idea of get us all in the system, get us in trouble. I mean, folks, I'll be honest with you. I pee in my backyard. I mean, who doesn't? Of course, this was in the front yard. I don't know.
Looking back on 2012, we ask ourselves how...
Ladies and gentlemen, we are into the second hour of worldwide broadcast. The main host of the Young Turks, Sink, is going to be joining us in the next hour. Coming up in about 30, 40 minutes, I'm going to break down the latest on what really happened in Benghazi and the aftermath of Hillary Clinton's ridiculous testimony and Rand Paul saying that if he was Obama, she should have been relieved of her office, of her position. I mean, they're all in on it. They ordered a stand down in Benghazi to cover up what was really happening there. 8 hours. Their own Al-Qaeda security they hired to run Benghazi are the ones that killed him. I mean, this is incredible. And none of the senators will bring that up. I mean, it's hiding in plain view. But their whole narrative falls apart. And they can't take our rights anymore if they point out that elements of the government, criminal elements, are running Al-Qaeda. Not the whole government. See, they go, oh, you're a 9/11 truther. Now, you're not saying there's not any Muslim extremists. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying our government uses them to take down countries and uses them to then menace America and take our liberties. That's coming up. Now, Dr. James Garrow, Ph.D., is a Canadian teacher and businessman. And in 1968, he founded the Beth Yun Institute, legendary language school in the People's Republic of China, named after the Canadian surgeon, Dr. Norman Beth Yun. I think I'm pronouncing that right. One day in 2000, Dr. Jim Garrow, executive director of the Institute's popular Pink Pagoda schools in China, found his assistant weeping. The woman told him how her sister's husband was insisting that the couple's newborn daughter be smothered to make way for a son under China's one-child policy. And this has now all been confirmed. Years ago, they would deny it. Garrow's promised to help and was able to place the infant with an adoptive couple. That's why you see so many Chinese girls in America now. Mainly adopted by evil white people, of course, because all whites are evil, according to people like... I've got a bizarre Daily Beast article here we're going to get to later, where they... Well, just wait till I cover it. It's absolutely, absolutely astounding when you see it. Admitting that they're getting rid of America and getting rid of our sovereignty, it's incredible. I've got to cover that today. Dr. James Garrow joins us because if you're up at Infowars.com, you can see this article. I'll also punch it up for people watching on television. Nobel Peace Prize nominee Obama asked military leaders if they will fire on U.S. citizens. Shock claim purported to come from one of America's foremost military leaders. Well, we've already got General Boykin, former head of special forces, saying our government, he believes, was giving weapons to Al-Qaeda, and that's what Benghazi is a cover-up. He believes? It's admitted. I mean, that's what's so incredible here. We don't know if it's Boykin. I'm going to try to find out here. But the point is, if you go to our article, and there was other articles that actually broke it in the Examiner and a couple others the day before, and I'm giving him credit. Our articles, though, back it up with the Army training manuals from 2010, FM3-39.40, internment and resettlement. It also has gun confiscation, how to take over cities. You can click on that and read that. The clergy response teams, the backup that, hey, this guy's credible. That's why we got him on. And I believe he's telling the truth. But I've talked to Colonel Roberts, whose nephew graduated from West Point, was in these Army meetings telling him 10 years ago we're getting ready to confiscate, you know, we're training to confiscate guns. I've been to the urban warfare drills. I mean, there's hundreds of data points. The Army National Guard trained in Iowa and Arcadia to confiscate guns. That was in the news. You know about this. You saw Katrina. But the litmus test is, will you fire on U.S. citizens? And they tried it in Katrina. They're doing the drills everywhere. But now they bought the 1.6 billion bullets. Now they're hiring people out of the military to move them into Homeland Security as a militarized domestic force. New York Times, scouts trained to fight terrorists and more 3.5 years ago. Those 14-year-old Explorer Scouts are now 17 and a half, training to, quote, take on disgruntled vets that wouldn't turn their guns in. First paragraph of the New York Times, with dozens of color photos showing the simulated killing with paintball guns of veterans in America. I've talked to ROTC people on air and confirmed they don't fight to, they don't train to fight Al-Qaeda. They train to fight U.S. militias. They've got four TV shows coming out this year demonizing American gun owners and how we're going to be the new terror force. Homeland Security is now converting over to the American people. Now I'm going to shut up and go to our guest. I wanted to back that up for people so you can go to our article, Nobel Peace Prize nominee Obama asked military leaders they will fire on U.S. citizens. Now, we're going to find out from the man himself who talked to this individual, Dr. James Garrow, Ph.D. Number one, I would say this military officer, you say is a foremost out there, needs to go public or they may die in a kayak accident like the former CIA director who exposed Waco and leaked the FLIR footage because he was upset about it. He better go, or she better go public with this right now. And I think it's better for you to do that because the system knows when a general or even a Pat Tillman, someone well-known comes out, that's the danger. If I'm up here showing Army manuals, they know the average person isn't going to go look those up and find out I'm telling the truth. So I'm going to go to you, Dr. James Garrow, PhD. Tell us how the story unfolds, what you were told. Then I want to get into saving Chinese girls before they get smothered or used for medical experiments. Thank you for joining us.
Well, thanks, Alex. I hope you can hear me fine.
Yes, sir. We got your video Skype and got you on phone. Tell us a little bit about yourself, for those that don't know, and then get into what this military officer told you, this individual.
Well, okay. First of all, I'm an educator, but a businessman. I operate schools in China. In the past, I've been a college president and the teacher's college principal here in Canada. So my background is education, but I also am involved in business, of course, in the country of China. I probably have the largest network of schools, foreign language schools in China. And the elites send their kids to our schools. So we know a lot about what's going on directly from the Chinese elite, the leaders. Hu Jintao's niece was in one of my schools, and the current leader, Xi Jinping, his daughter was in one of my schools, of course, is now in Harvard. But that's beside the point, but that gives you a little bit of background on me.
And I should have added, you've gotten 45,000 plus, and we actually, David Knight has adopted children from China who would have been disposed of, girls. So he vouches for you as well. I mean, I know who you are, but he says you're certainly the bona fide. So thank you for that information and saving 45,000 girls that the UN and the eugenicists say are worth nothing because they're such big feminists. Now let's get into this officer, what they told you, and elaborate on this information.
Shall do. I got a call the day before yesterday in the morning. From this officer, former officer, he's retired, but he was quite upset that one of the people he'd encouraged to join the military was being squeezed out, that he was forced to resign his commission, and it was because a question was asked of him. Now, I've called it a litmus test, but basically what it is, he was asked if in a situation where the military was called upon to go and confront people who were armed, American citizens who would not relinquish their arms, in spite of the Second Amendment right to hold arms, would you fire on American citizens? This gentleman related to me that the officer was totally flummoxed that he would be asked this question, and he said his answer was no, I would not fire on American citizens. And he was forced to resign his commission immediately.
Amazing. Tell us more about, to quote you here from the article, you basically described him as one of America's most foremost military heroes. Can you give us an idea about this person? Is this person going to go public? Can you tell us what else he relayed to you?
Well, we had an hour-long conversation, so it ran the gamut from talking about the transparency or lack of the manipulation of the mindset of the public as a result of a media that no longer actually reports news, but now spouts Obamaism. There was that part of the conversation. His concern, though, was that the military was going to be put in an awful position where they had to look at the oath they had taken, look at the officers who were also required to give an oath to obey the orders given by those above them, including the commander-in-chief, which would make it Obama. And if those orders were, in fact, to kill American civilians because they would not give up something they had a constitutional right to in the Second Amendment, namely their guns, he was afraid that so many would be leaving the military that it would leave a vacuum, actually, in fact, for people who would really be swearing allegiance to a new king, a new dictator, Obama. And that was his concern. This man is a legend. Yes, you would know his name. Every American would know his name. And no, he will not be coming public. He'll not be bringing it out in public. He thought that the best thing he could do is put it out in a different way. I was honored that he called me.
So it's not somebody like Boykin?
I can't give you the name. He's asked me not to. So in honoring that request, I won't answer that.
Well, I know several generals, and he'd be at the top of the list. And by knowing him, I know people that have worked with him, made films with some of these generals. And there's only a list of four or five that I know that would probably start talking about something like this. I mean, I know they're training for it. I have the video. I have the training manuals. It's really not a secret. And I've had military call in who said, we've been asked, are we going to fire on citizens? And then we're shipped overseas if we won't, or kicked out. And they're forming and then basically sheep dipping, making them quasi-CIA, Homeland Security, domestic, kind of NKVD units. And I got news for the establishment. You'll be able to kill Alex Jones, take out Ron Paul in the first wave. But once you kill the canaries, I would not want to be anybody in a government uniform at that point. And that's part of the plan, too, a civil war. I want to talk about your hour-long conversation with this person and where the military is training to kill us and take our guns. I mean, obviously, the Obama's controllers, the foreign globalists, they know this is designed to destroy the military and police, which is what you said. It gets rid of them because you're still going to have bad officers commanding them, and then brings in the new forces.
If you've ever wanted one of our best...
PinkPagodaGirls.com is the site of the foundation and organization that saved over 45,000 Chinese girls that would have been smothered, drowned, or medical experiments. Now they just come and pick them up. The state picks them up, and they just disappear off into a labyrinth of hell, just like the Falun Gong being blood-typed and then harvested for the elites for their organs. We're going to get into that in the next segment with our guest, Dr. James Garrow, Ph.D., very highly respected individual. You know, my guess, if I have to say who it is that it'd be somebody like Lieutenant General William Boykin, who's also exposing right now that our government's giving weapons to Al-Qaeda. And that's in the news today. That's coming up after our guest leaves us. And by the way, that's in the film Behold a Pale Horse, America's Last Chance, starring country music legend Charlie Daniels. And Boykin is in that film. That's why I'm guessing it'd be somebody like Boykin. Because, you know, you can disagree with some of his views in the past, but he is overall a patriot who's anti-New World Order and pro-sovereignty. And that's about the only kind of guy I'd see exposing that. Somebody like, you know, Dr. Paul Craig Roberts, who was in government, exposes this type of stuff. Another Roberts, Lieutenant Colonel, Roberts out of Oklahoma, he's exposed things like this. But, I mean, it's all out there. We're going to get into China coming up in the next segment. But what else, Dr. Garrow, can you relay to us in this hour-long conversation? And why did this senior household name, for anybody that knows military, one of America's foremost military heroes, to quote you, why would they come to you? Man, I mean, I know he knows you, and tell you this information and then say, get it out there, but I can't say, and then relay other things that he told you.
Well, I would suggest that he's talking in fear, that he knows that the Obama administration has a circle of death around them in terms of, I use that term because that has been said to me, because there are people who have met with an unfortunate fate, who have dared to cross Obama. But this gentleman came to me. I've known him for about 17 years, and he came to me as a result of the fact that he had read the book that I had just written about my work saving baby girls in China. And he had called me about 3 months ago, saying, "Hey, I bought a copy of your book. It's wonderful." Da 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 da. And that made the connection. So the other day when he called me, he was just saying, "Jim, look. I know you're connected with all sorts of people. You're on the net. You know how to do all these things. Would you put this out for me?" And I said that it would be an honor for me to do that.
Well, obviously, he's risking his life putting this out because the info's out there. And a lot of these older generals, he came to you because he doesn't understand the internet completely and how it works. You know, obviously, he knows the NSA is going to track this back. They're going to know the relationship. Obama knows. And, I guess he thinks that if he just puts it out through an intermediary, they won't go after him. The danger is now not going public full bore. That's when they come after you. But if they kill this foremost military hero, living hero, then everybody will know. In a way, I guess it's good that he did talk to you. But what else did he say about this other person he got to join the military years ago, now being asked if they'd fire on U.S. citizens? I mean, what else did he tell you about the plan to come after us?
Well, that's basically it. He was reflecting back to me what was being said to him about this poor fellow who he had encouraged to get involved in the military and the manager, you know, gone up the ranks. Suddenly, this litmus test was being put in front of him, and it was either, you know, you're going to agree or you're not. You're going to get squeezed out. So his concern was that good, loyal Americans who had decided to give their lives to the country in the service of the country were being put in such an awful position. I mean, this is the kind of thing that you would expect to have a test of loyalty, as it were, for people who were involved in Mao's regime or down in Chavez's regime or somewhere else, like the Nazis. This is the kind of thing they would have done. This isn't what happens in a democracy. This isn't what happens with people in the services, serving the nation, putting their lives on the line. This is just not what happens. So the shock here is the knowledge that this isn't just one person it's happening to. This person came forward. This person is somebody of integrity. But my goodness, it's not just this one gentleman. It's others and women who are put in this position of and are now being asked the question, would you in fact do this? And that was the shock for this this well-known American hero.
We're going to go to break, come back in a long segment and get into what's happening in China and the authoritarianism over there and what you've dealt with the killing of these little girls that you've been saving. But the countless millions you haven't been able to save, unfortunately. But I'm going to briefly, when we come back, break down for people and then get your take on this, that the military, and I've noticed even senior brass, they're experts in their area, but not in full spectrum. I know what the globalists are planning because I watch their propaganda, and they prepare the ground first before they do it. They have billed Obama as Lincoln. And now they're, and I said this 4 years ago, now they're saying that he's going to have a civil war and be our God, be our king. That they've got this set up.
We're on the mark.
I'm going to get into what we're facing here in just a moment. And I tell you, I know about some of the few generals that have actually been anti-New World Order to some extent. I know about a few of the generals that have met with people that I know who've been woken up now, mainly retired generals. I know about generals that have and admirals that have been shot and killed, you know, in the chest and in the head multiple times, and it's ruled suicides the last few years. All the generals you've seen having to resign, having to step down or resigning their commissions, admirals, heads of CENTCOM. The truth is our military keeps saying no, 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 no. Even handpicked guys from West Point in the military 30 years who've got whole careers and, you know, everything ahead of them the last few years, they are resigning. We're going to talk about that in a moment. Briefly, we are a listener-supported radio, filmmaking, news organization. And when you buy books and videos and materials at InfoWarsStore.com, you get the very lowest prices on things like ProPure stainless steel water filters with promo code water. You get 10% off. And you support the transmission. Wars are not cheap. Wars take money. And this is an info war. We know the truth will set us free, and that all that evil men and tyrants need to flourish is that good men and women do nothing. So again, we have the new T-shirt, Come and Take It. And inside the AK-47, it says, the right to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. And we also have Behold a Pale Horse that has General Boykin in it, a patriot exposing Agenda 21 and the entire New World Order system. So be sure and get all of that at InfoWarsStore.com and spread the word about the broadcast. I'm up here risking my life to get the word out because I realize how evil the globalists are. I realize there's no future if we don't beat them. They plan, and now shifting gears back to our guest, Dr. Jim Garrow, the big plan is this, and I've studied history. I've studied the Rand Corporation's writings. I've studied the writings of the leftist financed by the big banks that want a collectivist system for the grassroots, where the globalists are exempt from all the laws offshore, so they can then take our tax money as corporate welfare offshore, invest our pension funds in their fraudulent derivative scams to hold the entire financial system hostage. That's it in a nutshell. It's a corporate fascist system, a crony, anti-free market, capitalist monopoly system sitting on top of a lower-tier socialism communism, social engineering program. And I started seeing this 5 years ago, and I'm on record in Obama deception 4 years ago. I'm on record in Fall of the Republic 3.5 years ago, two films about Obama, saying they're building him up as a messianic Christ. They keep saying, he's Lincoln, he's Lincoln. He'll be like Lincoln, you'll see. And I said, they're doing that to later, if they decide to bring in martial law, say he's Lincoln who will crush the states. Then he creates the 10 region governors to say, oh, I don't need 50 states, I've got 10 appointed governors. He creates the rural council over communities in all over the country. And I'm going to get our guest take on this. And says Homeland Security and the Pentagon is over that. And then we get the training manuals for it. It's gun confiscation. Okay, so this is totally, absolutely creepy. And now they're, and I've done reports on this, we're going to do another this week because it's paramount, they're saying, he's Lincoln, let the states, and I even have an article here today, let the states not turn their guns in, let the legislature say no. He's Lincoln and will crush a new civil war. Well, we're not going to start a war. They're going to go out and try to take the guns, provocateur stuff, a new Waco if they have to, and they're going to try to elicit a 1776. So that's why I got it out in the open on Piers Morgan and said it will trigger a new 1776, not to cause one, but to point out to everybody out there in TV land, hey, this isn't going to be fun. Now, I'm going to shut up and go to our guest. As we went to break and I said that, he was nodding his head going, absolutely, that's what he said. So what did the general, because we know who you're talking about. I know who goes in these Christian circles. I went and did some searching. I think I know who the foremost military hero is. But again, I think he's made a mistake only going through you, his 17-year friend. The system, if I can figure this out in about 5 minutes, the system knows without even using phone tracking systems. So tell the general, he's not stupid, that he needs to go completely public. But going back to you here, sir, what is your take on what I just said of the master plan? They plan to start a war using guns to then label all conservatives and libertarians the enemy, which is in all the Homeland Security training manuals that we got from state police and federal marshals. Go ahead.
You know, Alex, the only time I've ever seen you, and, you know, I'm not a watcher of programs like yours, but the only time I've seen you was when I went and did a little bit of research, and I ran across this thing where you took on this British guy, Piers Morgan, you just mentioned him.
Yes.
And I thought, you know, you just fried the guy. You just fried him. But you put it out there with such intensity that I thought, you know, maybe I'm going to get fried today. I don't know. But you know what? You're hot, man. You're on the money. When you talk about them setting it up to take away the guns, and they're looking for the crisis. Come on, that's what Valerie Jarrett has been pushing Obama into. Create a crisis. And your military friends, they all are aware of what's going on. The nightmare for them, the nightmare scenario, is having to turn their guns on American civilians because the new emperor, or at least the guy who thinks he's the new potentate, thinks that he can just go out there, crush the Second Amendment, crush the Constitution, and then crush anyone who gets in his way. What's been the pattern, Alex, so far? When people get in his way, what happens to them?
And that's because the globalists are taking over everywhere. He's their puppet. I saw a video of the Speaker of the House at a dinner groveling to Michelle Obama and her rolling her eyes and batting him away. It is pathetic how Congress, sycophantically through fear, is lining up to serve Obama. What did your military source say? Because when I walked out after the break, you were saying, that's dead on, that's what it is. Was the military source saying they want a civil war? Or were you agreeing with my analysis? Because we have all these top Democrats saying we need a big crisis to make you king.
Alex, it was my military contact who said it is so obvious to him, so obvious to the man that was resigning, that what they were setting up was a takeover, a total takeover by Obama and using the military to have it happen. And if the military will not, if they'll not give the right answer to this litmus test, they've got a whole army of young kids who don't know any better, ready to move in. And keep in mind, who are the people who get away with in the despotic times? Who are the ones that they rely on in the end? It's the young kids who don't know any better, but who can point a gun and kill people.
Wait a minute. So your military source knows about the FEMA Corps. Now, this isn't secret, but it's not well known to the public. Describe what he told you about that, about the Ugin squads from about, 17 down to 14?
Well, his words exactly were, here's the Hitler Youth being resurrected now under this name of Obama Corps. That's exactly what he said.
Oh, Mike, this is devastating. This is devastating. Because I've gone and looked this up before I got you on, and I know the big Christian circles you're in. I 99% I know, and I've talked to you off air, and you're just like, nope, I'm not talking. But I know who this is. And I know other military officers, colonels and others, that are saying the same thing. I've got family that told me years ago I was right about everything, but now won't even talk to me, who's in the Army. I mean, this is because they've been passed over promotion just because they're related to me. And I mean, this is amazing that this is going on. I mean,
are you armed? Are you armed? Do you have armament?
Yes, I do. Yes, I do.
Well, you need them. And, you know, the vice president of my company in the U.S. is a guy named Eric Rush, who happens to be a black guy who's a journalist in your country. Well, you know what I did for him yesterday? I purchased him an AR-15 and a sidearm because I am so worried about the things that are being said right now. He's out there putting it out through WorldNet Daily, I think's the name. Putting the word out, letting people know the dangers of what, are you ready for this? What China is demanding of Obama.
No. China, we broke it a month ago, the Drudge Report, drudgereport.com link to it. Their People's Daily, I know you're in China and been there, you know it. Their TV said, you will, quote, have a war against your gun owners. We're ready to back you, and they're the biggest owner of the debt. And then I've got a Daily Beast article where they said, it's good that Piers Morgan is leading the anti-gun deal. We need to get Americans used to foreigners running things. I mean, this is insane. Go break down what's happening in China.
Well, what's happening in China is they know, well, first of all, do you know that the Chinese call Obama the monkey man? Do you know that?
I've seen that in the news, yes.
Yeah, it has nothing to do with him being black. It has everything to do with the way they treat monkeys. Monkeys are like puppets in China. So Obama is looked upon as a puppet of China. That's how he's looked upon. And they know full well that when he comes hat in hand, begging for more dollars, they're going to make more demands. Were you the one who broke the news about the fact that in Idaho, they've set up this thing very much like Shenzhen, China, a special economic zone? Was that you, Alex?
Yes, we're one of the ones, and now Jerome Corsi has confirmed that all over the U.S., I actually visited some of these in my first film, they're setting up these economic zones where the government lets the Chinese government be tax-free, but then citizens aren't. That's the model in the future. Globalist will be tax-free, but we will be under Agenda 21.
Well, you know, I've talked to Joseph Farah about that. I've talked to Jerome Corsi about that very thing. You know, Jerry Corsi, he endorsed my book. And my book came out through Joseph Farah. But I'm telling you, the information that's available to some people about what's going on in China and how they're treating the American land and the American resources, they're treating it as this. It is something which they will be able to grab sometime soon. And so the fact that they now have five special economic zones throughout the United States, you've got to be aware of what's happening. The fact that discussions have taken place with Obama and some of his officials in China to talk about
the NAFTA superhighway is their invasion route from the Pacific side of Mexico right into the U.S., and they're going to be brought in. I've talked to top officers, but it's even in the Washington Post, agreements to bring in, under NLE 09, troops from 15 nations to quell domestic unrest. That's at FEMA.gov.
Mm-hmm.
And guess who was on the list of the 15 nations?
Who? Wouldn't be China, would it?
Oh, yeah. That's what I'm telling listeners. It's all, and people say that'll never happen. Once they start a civil war, it will.
Yeah, it's already happening. They're setting it up for civil war. They're setting it up to take away the freedom of the American people. And Obama, he doesn't believe in freedom. He doesn't believe you should ever have a gun. Thank God.
What else did your military source because, again, if you're a new listener, folks, China officially said, quote, have a war against your gun owners. We will back you in their biggest TV, state run, and the People's Daily. I mean, they're openly saying this and saying, we own your debt. You take their guns. I mean, and then I've got a Daily Beast article saying it's good that foreigners are telling us what to do. In fact, I'm going to dig it up here. I'm trying to find it.
No, and you're absolutely correct, Alex. It's exactly what's going on. The Chinese are demanding that Obama take control of the guns, because as they move in and steal the resources of America, buy them out in satisfaction of the debt, which Obama knows full well he cannot pay. When you know you're not going to be able to pay your credit card, why don't you run it up as far as you can? As long as they're saying yes, right? get as much goodies as you possibly can. That's the mindset of Obama.
Well,
and he knows full well he will never have to actually pay the debt. All he has to do is say, hey, we've already shut down the oil industry. They're not drilling. We'll give you permission to drill. We've already destroyed the coal industry in America. So come, take the coal. You can use it. It's a better coal than you have in China. They need it. They need the resources of America, and that's what they are demanding from Obama.
And let's be clear about this. China has been maneuvered to be the biggest owner of our debt by the Federal Reserve, who set this up when they could have just monetized and paid the debt that way. Instead, they had the Chinese communists come in who kill, you know, millions of their dissidents on record because they're the model of globalism. We're told by the CFR, China is the model, not the Chinese people, the authoritarianism. They use the slave wages, the apple factories with the suicide nets, so no one can compete in the West to consolidate power in globalist hands. And then the Chinese People's Daily and their biggest TV station, we did a news article linked to it. Paul Watson was aware of it because his wife is Chinese, and she first alerted it. Paul went and found the actual English version of it. And they say, I've read this on air, listeners can go pull it up. In fact, guys, the headline is something like Chinese state-run media tells Obama to take the guns. Pull up the InfoWars for me, guys. Good job. I want to show viewers, radio listeners, pull it up. And they say, quote, wage war against the gun owners. Do whatever it takes. It's key. We are, you know, we've given you money. And again, they're going to be given the national parks. The land is collateral. That's all official. The Chinese communists were being conquered. And they're saying, hey, we own your people now. You take their guns. I mean, and now the UN treaty is coming up. This is the master plan. It's so evil.
Yeah, you know, it's funny, but I was told, you know, when I checked with my friends, I said, have you ever heard of this guy, Alex Jones? And one of my American friends said, well, you know, he's a bit of a conspiracy theory nut. And, you know, now I've come on, I've listened to what you've had to say, and I'm sitting here going, wow, well, this guy's not a nut. You have the information. I don't know where you're getting this, but I'm telling you, you are right on the money. And keep in mind something. Yamamoto was right when he said, you don't want to invade America because behind every blade of grass there'll be a gun. And you know, the Chinese know full well that's exactly the situation with America right now. Obama knows. He's got his marching orders. He's been told to take your guns. He's been told to have your people crushed so that the Chinese can do what they want.
You're right. And we did find that People's Daily, one of the articles, where it says innocent blood demands gun control, and then it talks about waging war against American gun owners. But here's the article. Peers pressure. Believe it or not, Morgan is a great spokesman for gun control. And the article goes on to say he is globalization 2.0, you know, teaching us to basically go under global government. And that we'll only survive if we submit to this. I mean, this is amazing what they've done to us.
Oh, absolutely. You've been manipulated every which way but loose. They know full well that the here's the other thing. The United Nations and the World Bank, in collusion with Obama, suppose he turns around and says to them or to the world community, you know what? We cannot meet the debt. Could you help us out here? Could you help us broker a fair solution and pay off the debt in some way possible, in whatever way possible? And the United Nations will be, and the World Bank will be glad to say, yes, we'll come in. In fact, let's just do this. Let's look at Idaho. Look what you got out there. You got all this open space. Let's look at Kansas. We need the breadbasket. We need to be able to grow grain.
And that's why they've got to have Obama as the head of the UN Security Council, violating Article 1, Section 9, Clause 8. That's why they admit in this Daily Beast article by Peter Beinart, who really shows he's a globalist, they've got to get us used to this. They've got to get us ready to go under world government. It's so incredibly sick that they've maneuvered us to this point. And by the way, they found it in the People's Daily. Punch it back up for me, guys. They found where it said Obama needs to engage in a protracted war. You guys just had it. You had it right on the spot with the war part. That's what I wanted to read on air. TV viewers saw it. There it is. Action speaks louder than words. If Obama wants to take practical measures to control guns, he has to make preparation for a protracted war and considerable political cost. Then they go on to say the Chinese government's ready to help. What do you make of that? I mean, that is just in our face.
Yeah. Well, here, keep in mind, yeah, it's an incremental thing. And that's what this guy is. Obama's all about incrementalism. What's he done to the American public? Would you ever countenance for 1 minute any man putting their hands on your wife. Would you ever? Wouldn't you deck the person who do that?
But now you do, TSA.
Every time you go into the airport, every time.
Stay there. TSA. We're going to come back. We're going to come back. You know what's going on. Well, this is the end of our interview. You're in about 6 minutes with Jim Garrow. But I want to get him back on for a full hour next week or as soon as he can. He saved over 45,000 young, newborn baby Chinese girls that would have been killed. And he joins us right now. Here's the Daily Beast, okay? And there are literally dozens of similar articles by Peter Beinart, or Beinart, how you pronounce it. And this is, of course, Newsweek's biggest publication online. And they say, we got to get Americans used to globalism. You got to go read it. And that we're preparing everybody and that America's power is in decline. Globalization means that other nations will influence and judge us and that we must basically do what they say. And they go on to say, Chinese officials are lecturing us, and that's good. That's a quote. Mexican billionaires are lecturing us. That's good. I mean, you got to go read this. And then it goes on to say, Al Jazeera's purchased Current TV. That's good. It's good for us to go under foreign control. And then he says, somewhere, Alex Jones is readying his flamethrower. Let him. Because in the next round of the culture war, we will likely not just pit black and brown versus white. That's why they get on the news and say, gun owning is racist. We're going to get the whites. That's why Rangel's saying whites are the enemy. You know, Southerners are the enemy. Gun owners are the enemy. And you're like, that's really crazy. You know, political correctness teaches everybody to be nice, which is, but then, they, again, this is all a plan. And secular versus religious. It will pit those Americans who can't accept the increased let's just go to our guest. It says Alex is readying his flamethrower. Let him. They basically just say they're going to smash us. I'm seeing this everywhere, and I've seen this in the Weatherman FBI trials where some of them admitted to being in these meetings where they said we're going to kill the libertarians and conservatives. They said we're going to put them in re-education camps. We're going to bring the Chinese in to do this. I mean, this is insanity. But they're really, it looks like, going to try it with the Civil War as the cover, kicked off by taking the guns. I just read that, where they say, Alex Jones is our enemy, don't worry, we're going to get him. I mean, Piers Morgan has said he wants to shoot me. What do you make of these people?
Well, you know, the Founding Fathers knew exactly what was going to come down the pipe. If ever people lost sight of why the Constitution was built the way it was, why the Republic was framed the way it was, And what you're doing, you are actually, and, you know, again, I'm back to this thing of where is this nutcase Alex Jones coming from? Well, you're not. You're on the money. And you are providing the protection that the Fifth Estate, that the people in the media should be providing the people of the United States by exposing the very things that you're talking about. There's a huge, I'm going to say it because there's the word, there's conspiracy, there's complicity all over the United States. And, you know, your poor military people are sitting there. They know. They are aware. They know the manipulation. They know the expectation that they will be called upon to move against the American people. These people are heartsick. They're heartsick of the portent of having to turn their guns against their own people. And so they're walking out in droves, Alex.
Which is part of the plan, because they already have the collaborators lined up ready to take over.
That's right. And by the way, one of the first people.
Well, they should say yes, they will in this situation and infiltrate the New World Order. I mean, that's completely biblical, just like the, you know, the spies visiting the city. And, you know, I mean, that's got to be done. I say just say, yeah, I'll fire on them and then sit there and warn everybody behind the scenes. And I think that's the answer here.
Well, it would be great if they were left to that, if they weren't put in positions where they have to actually say no all over the place. And remember, these people are crafty. Look at Obama. Has anyone ever made Obama stand up in public where he was actually questioned about everything in his past?
No, everything's always staged. I mean, he's got three different names. Everything's sealed.
Yeah. What's with this? What happened to a legal system that, you know, pulls back the onion and everyone has justice applied to them equally? Well, Obama, golly gee, what's going on with him?
Amazing. James Garrow, we've got to have you back up again soon. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Alex.
PinkPagodaGirls.com. That was such an amazing interview. with Jim Garrow. And we've done some research on him the last 48 hours and were able to connect dots. And then I was able to talk to him off air and get his response. And I believe with about 97% certainty, actually I'm completely certain, that the individual that told him that high-level military people that he'd recruited and gotten in, special forces, that the person that they're talking about is the man that's in the film Behold a Pale Horse, available, by the way, at InfoWarsStore.com if you want to get it there and support us, that we're talking about retired former head of special forces, General William Boykin. Because of the Christian circles, and I happen to know Boykin's been involved trying to help get Chinese girls out of China so they're not aborted after birth. They kill them up to a couple of years. Parents hide them and stuff. And it kind of freaked him out there when I went out there and said, is it Boykin? And the guy's like, I'm not going to sit there and do this question and answer. Boy, you really are smart. How do you know? So the point is that, well, there's not many people that even have the courage to, and of course, it's on record that he runs in the circles with Boykin and they know each other. And obviously, Boykin knows the government knows that. And I'm not saying he's not a really smart guy, but at the same time, you know, he went to this fella because he's like, well, you know about the internet. Can I work through you? We need to get a hold of the filmmaker. He's been trying to get a hold of me. I've just been too busy to talk to him. I've been too busy to even call my other source. I'm just completely overwhelmed at this point. I mean, I'm going to be honest with everybody, but I already know their battle plan. And I just continue to get more intel and more data on them. And it's a bold move. Fortune favors the bold, and the globalists are bold. That's why I'm bold. And, you know, Pat Tillman found out they were growing drugs and doing all this evil stuff in Afghanistan. He was going to go public, so they killed him. And I think General Boykin, he's already gone public in Behold a Pale Horse. He's already exposed. Well, actually, Boykin is in CNS News today saying our government is arming the Al-Qaeda and giving them weapons in Syria. So that's actually in the news today. So it's Boykin, 97%, and I guess we need to get a hold of Boykin. We know who to call to get his number. I don't know why I haven't tried to get Boykin on to begin with. And we need to just, I need to talk to him and go, look, General, it's time to just go all the way. It's time to get your missiles launched before they blow you up on the pad. And I'm just telling you right now, ladies and gentlemen, that's what we got to do. And me, I'm in God's hands. I'm not worried about it. He said the military living legend is scared. And I guess when you're an old man and been in all that combat earlier, and it's not even scared, it's sad, freaked out. It's like, wow, it's really happening. They're really getting the military ready to come confiscate guns, have a civil war, and bring in the Chinese communist. Let me tell you, a lot of mainline conservatives are all talk, folks. They'll get out and salute the Reds if they came in here. I'm telling you right now. I mean, they'd line up. I mean, look, all the TV shows badmouth George Washington. I mean, if they had a public hanging in Austin, for me, people get out there and salute while they hung my butt. I guarantee it. Most people are cowards, and they love evil. But I got news for the New World Order. There's a good 15% of people aren't going to back down, and they're men and women. And so good luck with that big highway that just got completed, almost all of it from the southern Pacific side of Mexico right up into Texas. And they've built it right up into San Antonio and right up to the extension around town. And we stopped it just north of here, fighting it as hard as we could, that globalist taxation control grid, to run the Chinese troops up. We killed it dead just north of Austin. And here we are fighting as hard as we can. And most people cannot believe how serious this is, how real this is. But you're going to find out. We're trying to stop them, but if we don't stop them, boy, just remember you were warned.
They think of President Obama's assault weapons ban. If the feds start confiscating assault weapons, will you turn your guns in?
Absolutely not. No chance. I completely disagree with what President Obama said the other day and his order and all that, and I will not turn any of my guns in, and there's nothing they can really do that will change my mind about that.
Well, personally, I don't have any guns on me, but if I did, I probably wouldn't. Just a matter of, you know, protection for myself, or if I had a family, for my family.
I don't own any guns, so I don't have any to turn in.
Do you think other people should turn them in?
I do. I think that you should follow the law. And also, I'm kind of against assault weapon guns and guns in general. And I don't see that there's that much of a need for them. If everyone turns them in, then you won't need them to defend other against other people with.
I don't own any assault weapons, but I am a gun owner. And my guns would be in compliance with those new laws, and so it wouldn't personally affect me. But if I did own assault weapons, I would comply with the law, because I don't think that other than the headstrong Southern attitude that I have, what's mine is mine, there's no reason to be owning assault weapons in a just personal setting.
How do you feel about President Obama bringing children on stage as he talks about gun control, yet he's killed at least 168 kids in drone attacks in Pakistan?
I think national security and domestic security are two different issues, and that security abroad is a separate issue entirely from security inside the nation.
I feel that's kind of almost hypocritical in a way.
Yeah, I don't agree with that. I think that dragging kids into it and having them listen to all this stuff, they do need to be educated, but I think they're way too young, and I think that's wrong. I don't agree with that at all.
I mean, I don't think it's fair to bring kids onto the stage as he talks about it. It's kind of unfair to make his point that way, but I think a life's a life, and it shouldn't be lost either way. So I think it needs to be on both sides. He needs to value the life of his children as much as, you know, Pakistani civilians.
Maybe he feels bad about all the kids that he has unintentionally killed, and he's trying to make up for that by saying that, you know, by bringing the kids on stage.
No one is, he's not, in that, in the way of asking the question, that way you're making the blame go specifically on a single person, on the President of the United States, when it's a much more complicated and complex issue. And then in those sort of situations, you can't place the blame on one person. Yes, people have died, but people die in any sort of conflict. I don't personally agree with our presence in the Middle East, but I'm going to support our president in the sort of decisions he makes. And I think that having drones in the Middle East saves American lives. And when it comes down to it, like, American lives are what our policies are about saving.
Now, do you think it's un-American if local or state governments push back on the feds in relation to the assault weapons ban?
No, I don't think it's un-American, just because I think that within America, each state does have its right to make their own laws. And
I don't think that it's un-American. I find that states, when they have enough reason to stray away from the national government, it is their right to do that.
I guess it would be considered un-American to push the feds back, because these are the same people that we expect to protect us. We are the same people who we expect to watch our homeland security.
Okay, and lastly, can you recite the Second Amendment?
The Second Amendment. No, I cannot at this point. I forgot clearly. I know the first one, freedom of speech. Second one should be right to the press, isn't it? Right to press, or yeah, it's probably that. I should feel ashamed of myself, though, wanting to be a lawyer. Yeah.
The right to bear arms. Every citizen should have the right to bear arms.
And it mentions in there something about a militia.
I don't. I used to know it. I'm sorry.
The right to bear arms.
Okay, and it mentions something about a militia in the Second Amendment.
Oh, my bad. No, I've no idea what it is. Could you say it to me?
I cannot.
Reporting for InfoWars Nightly News, I'm David Ortiz.
There will be pundits and politicians and special interest lobbyists publicly warning of a tyrannical, all-out assault on liberty.
Alex Jones here for InfoWars.com with a special report. Most people that watch television or even YouTube know that last Monday I debated Piers Morgan and got in his face and said, look, you're coming for our guns to enslave us. America is becoming a police state tyranny. Back off. Hitler took the guns. Stalin took the guns. Mao took the guns. Fidel Castro took the guns. Hugo Chavez took the guns. And I'm here to tell you, 1776 will commence again if you try to take our firearms. Doesn't matter how many lemmings you get out there on the street begging for them to have their guns taken. We will not relinquish them. Do you understand? 2 days later, Ron Paul came on my show, outgoing congressman, and he agreed. He said if they come for the guns, it's going to cause a civil war, 1776, part two. Will you turn in your semi-autos?
Well, I might not even have anything to turn in for that purpose, but I don't think the American people will. I've always assumed that the line in the sand may well be drawn. If the federal agent marches in unannounced and they say, well, give me your gun and give me your gold, I don't think they'll do that, calmly. I think the American people will highly resent it and resist.
Now, as soon as I got off Piers Morgan, the White House released a press release and said they were watching and responded to our petition, your petition, to deport Piers Morgan for engaging in political subterfuge and trying to overthrow our Bill of Rights and Constitution. So we know they were watching. It became the biggest story in the country and the biggest story on Twitter for 2 days straight. It's had like 15 million views online on YouTube alone. So we know the White House is watching. We also know that it's come out in Homeland Security documents that myself and Matt Drudge have been basically investigated and surveilled and are in secret documents concerning the TSA because we've been covering their out-of-control violations of the Fourth Amendment and conditioning the public to basically be slaves. But then today, I'm watching his speech while I'm live on the radio playing it, and he talks about these pundits out there who just want to make money. And they say that... All right, ladies and gentlemen, we had some technical difficulties with the Skype, but he's with us via phone, so we were doing a retransmission of some special reports there for the rest of the hour. He's a busy guy. Cenk Uygur, of course, founder and host of The Young Turks, theyoungturks.com, is on with us. He, of course, left MSNBC for several different reasons we're going to talk about. He went over to Current TV with Al Gore involved and the Hyatts and others, and then now that's been bought out by Al Jazeera. And he joins us. He has one of the biggest media networks on the internet out there, probably only rivaled by Infowars.com or what Glenn Beck has developed over there with The Blaze. And then, of course, there's the big granddaddy of all the real alternative media, and that's DrudgeReport.com. But, Cenk, it is good to have you on with us. I was looking forward to the full hour, but you promised to come back soon as we can get your Skype going for the TV viewers. But the radio listeners out there are excited to hear you on the broadcast. Where should we begin in this discussion today?
You tell me, Alex. We can talk policy. We can talk shows, politics. You let me know.
Let's talk about you a little bit. Most of the audience knows who you are, but I mean, how did you get started? How did you form your political beliefs?
Good question. So when I was growing up, I was a liberal Republican in the Northeast. That, of course, doesn't exist anymore, but it did back in the day. Voted for Tom Kaine. Not voted for. I was too young, but supported Tom Kaine, Whitman, et cetera, right? And then the Republicans lost me during George W. Bush. Gore was actually the first Democrat I ever voted for in 2000. They lost me on a couple things. The Clinton affair was fun and funny, but I thought it was crazy to impeach a president over that. Then they really lost me during the Iraq War, and then they really lost me during torture, and then they went down the spider hole of, warrantless wiretapping, gigantic abuses of our rights and civil liberties, et cetera. And I consider myself an independent. The Democrats drive me absolutely crazy. I am a progressive, meaning that I believe in expansion of freedom. I believe in protecting the middle class, et cetera. And there are some progressive in Congress, but not much. And Obama, I think, is nowhere near a progressive. So that's in a nutshell.
All right. Well, because we got you on later today, I'm going to skip this network break coming up because I want to get down to brass tacks with you. You're obviously a smart guy, and so you know that both parties are bought and paid for by some of the very same globalist above the law, don't pay taxes interest. And that, I mean, who can deny the police state has been continued and accelerated by Obama with NDAA? They found torture camps in Benghazi, the rendition flights, all of it is continuing. And I've seen the so-called left suddenly become cheerleaders for it. You not so much, but I mean, still, it's just another wing of the same carrion bird. And then I come on your show and you're like, man, do you need mental help? You know, you're so upset about all this. I don't think it's a conspiracy. Well, it's an open conspiracy. I mean, don't you care about your family, Cenk? You're a smart guy. You've got to know that if you've looked at history, the United States is absolutely headed over the edge of a cliff, politically, economically, culturally. I mean, this country is rotting socioeconomically on so many fronts, morally. And the police are dressed in Darth Vader outfits. The NSA is spying on us. And they're talking about Obama's going to be the new Lincoln and crush the states. I mean, this is creepy.
All right. So, Alex, I actually totally agree with you on 3 out of 4 things. It's just the fourth one, we have a wild, complete disagreement. Okay, but so let me tell you what I agree with you on. So does money control politics? Of course it does. And it watching television drives me crazy, where they talk about, oh, Joe Lieberman had this policy idea, and Senator X cares about this ideology. That's nonsense. The only thing that matters is what their donors tell them to do. I mean, New York Times had a brilliant article about how this pharmaceutical company, Amgen, just bought a $500 million exemption in the latest fiscal cliff deal. It makes me sick. And by the way, who'd they buy? They bought Republicans and Democrats. Max Baucus, Obama, McConnell, and Orrin Hatch. So, totally agree on that.
Well, take Al Gore. Take Al Gore getting all that oil money. I mean, how many tens of millions? What is it, 100 million? Some estimates. And we all know that Al Jazeera is backed by a government.
Well, so let me leave that aside for now. We can get back into it because I don't think it's as directly pertinent to our current sitting politicians that take the money for specific acts. But let me just finish real quick. Police state, I agree with you. The NDAA, warrantless wiretapping, it's encroaching. Power begets power, you know, and they just, there's never an end to how much power they can have, okay? So I agree with you on that, too. But the final piece of the puzzle, when you say talk about the reasons why, that's where we have the huge disagreement, Alex. And look, I think the reasons are super obvious. I mean, you said a conspiracy out in the open. I mean, you want to talk about a conspiracy out in the open? The lobbyists say we will give $100,000 to this guy, and we will hire his chief of staff, and we will hire him after he retires. They funnel all this money. And then they get the money back.
And then you got Congress insider trading.
So
if the power is all massing and foreign corporations and global corporations are taking control, don't you see then the wisdom for the people to be armed as a balance of power, as a check and a balance?
I understand what you're saying there, Alex, but I think it's unrealistic in a couple of different ways, and I think it has a huge a downside, okay? So, number one, when I say it's unrealistic, look, man, we can have all the guns you want, and we could be out in the woods. When the government comes with drones, if they wanted to do that, I don't think they're going to do that, but if they wanted to do that, I mean, they blow us out of the sky. You can have 28 AK-47s.
Really? Really?
You're never going to be
200,000 U.S. troops couldn't hold Baghdad. I believe you're wrong about that, and our people are inside the military. If they start trying to use the drones, even if they're automated and controlled by the globalists, people in the military are going to wreck those systems. Humans are powerful machines. There's hundreds of millions of us. I've been to the urban warfare drills where the military trains against U.S. role players to confiscate guns in U.S. cities, Cenk. I have the Army manuals. In fact, I can give you one of them for gun confiscation and FEMA camps and how to round up civil disturbance operations, FM3-39.40. I mean, there I am giving you the actual document number. You can look it up. This is real, is what I'm telling you. The 1.6 billion bullets the government bought. I mean, if they've got drones, why do they want 1.6 billion bullets? Because it's boots on the ground. They're going to have to come in our houses.
Well, I can answer why they want the 1.6 billion bullets, because somebody made money off of it. There's a bullet maker. They bribe the legalized bribery that they do of politicians, and so the government bought 1.6 billion bullets they don't need. Like, there's one other point of agreement we have, which is that I think there's going to be a gigantic collapse coming, and I think what happens after the collapse is enormously important, and we might disagree as to why that collapse is coming, but our main point of disagreement is when you start talking about the FEMA camps, et cetera. Look, I don't think there is a government plan to put us in FEMA camps or to kill us or to take us over because they don't need it. They already have the government. Alex, the only thing they care about is making more money. And right now they have almost 100% control of the government. They can make all the money they want. Why would they want to disturb that system? they're milking us dry on that count anyway.
Well, I get the points you're making, and it's true that we've already been taken over. They're already looting us, so why physically do it? It is the instinct of tyrants to fully dominate. I mean, why did Hitler, after he'd already taken France, just not stop there? Why'd he turn off into Russia, where Napoleon and every other empire went to die? It is the nature of these people. So you come off as a real guy, and I'm a pretty good judge of people, and so you are judging other people by how you operate. And, you know, I don't blame you not wanting to talk about Al Gore and people, but, I mean, Al Gore has the carbon trading company over in London and would literally make money off of every human activity we make if he gets carbon taxes through. I mean, that isn't about the environment. It's about a power grab.
No, Alex, I don't mind talking about Gore. I wanted to talk about, you know, your specific question first. But, look, I don't know all the investments that Al Gore has at all, right? I do know somebody comes in like Al Jazeera, and they make an offer that appears to be fantastic, above market value, if you ask me. And I don't know the specifics. I'm just guessing from the outside. I'm not involved in the deal at all. Anybody would have taken it. So does that, I mean, he's not in power anymore politically. I don't, you know, so there isn't any, I don't think, any extra favors to be had. He just got an awesome price and he took it. Now, the carbon tax thing, look, I just don't believe at all that it's meant to be a money-making enterprise. And I've talked to him at length for a long, long time. The man deeply cares about global warming. Now, you might disagree with him.
Oh, he deeply cares about the carbon trading he'll make billions off of. Of course he does. He deeply cares about the Apple Foxconn suicide nets. Does he deeply care about...
You told me you do the same thing, though. And here, let me explain what I mean by that. Like, for example, you think the economy is in trouble, so you invest in gold, right? We talked about that before.
Yes.
So then you make money off of that. Well, that makes sense. That's where you thought the economy was going. I don't even blame the hedge fund guys like John Paulson, who thought, wait a minute, these toxic mortgages are crap. I'm going to bet against them. And they made billions off of that, right? So if Al Gore sees that this fossil fuel industry is unsustainable, and he's right about that, and it's hurting our health, our wealth, everything else, and he bets in the opposite direction, well, that's logical. I'd do the same thing.
Yeah, but carbon taxes are selectively enforced only against the West and designed to shut down our development and then move it to Chinese investments and Indian investments that people like Al Gore have. It's a managed, crony, capitalist economy, and it's completely cold-blooded. You know, it was Gore that got up there on Larry King Live and said, it's a great deal, Larry. I deeply believe in NAFTA and GATT. How has NAFTA and GATT been for us?
Well, look, I was in favor of NAFTA, and I thought, you know, even though I was a Republican at the time, I thought Gore clearly won the debate against Ross Perot on that issue, et cetera. But NAFTA has had some significant downsides. There's no question about that. And I'll tell you, at this point, I get that a lot of the global trade deals are done for the benefit of corporations and to our great detriment. I mean, look, I'll tell you, I'll give you one example that really proves that case. It's the Panama deal. There's almost no trade with Panama in terms of business, commodities, et cetera. But Panama protects the bankers. And so recent trade deal that Obama did, he included Panama in the deal with other countries. Why? Because it created a giant loophole for the bankers to pay no taxes. Come on, why would you do that? I mean, especially if you're claiming to be a progressive, liberal, Democrat, and you give the bankers this giant multi-billion-dollar loophole. No, it's because the corporations run the place. Dick Durbin said it. He said the banks own Capitol Hill. So on that count, there's no question.
We're talking to the founder of the popular internet and TV and radio empire, Jink, joins us right now. TheYoungTurks.com is the main website, one of many they have. Look, here's how my brain works. You're sitting there going, oh, come on. So Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan, a few others, they knew the derivatives were garbage, so they bet against them. Yeah, but they also sold them to their clients and originally got the law changed in 99 to be able to sell the crap. So they
Totally true.
Okay.
That was fraud. And so when you talk about the guys who sold it to their clients and then shorted it and then bet against it, well, that's just outright fraud. Those guys should be in jail. And Goldman Sachs and all those guys did it. And John Paulson, you know, so I might have picked a poor example because he he was worked with Goldman Sachs to sell the toxic stuff to other people while he was betting against it. But there were some people, like if you read The Big Short by was it Michael Lewis?
Stay there. Jink Uger is our guest. And we're going to be right back, founder and head of the Young Turks. We're going to get into a whole bunch of other issues, Second Amendment, you name it, and what he thinks the collapse is going to look like. And is he worried about martial law? All this and more coming up.
Work. We're living on
the edge. Jink Uger of the Young Turks is our guest, and they've had a lot of fun with me over the years making jokes out of things. I'm going to talk about the CPS taking people's kids. We can discuss that. Also, the so-called liberal media is running like a four-year-old video of me talking about juice boxes to make you gay, and they take it out of context. I'm pointing out that animals, mammals, you name it, are becoming sterile or bisexual or having both organs. Girls are going into puberty now at average of age 10, used to be 14. Boys, testicles are not dropping. Genitals are smaller. They're becoming feminine. Women are becoming hyperfeminine. The bisphenol A and other things are directly linked to cancer and infertility. All of this, and the media just says, oh, you're making fun of gay people. It has nothing to do with that. It's a way to get the news out to say, are the juice boxes making you gay coming up? And then I'm like, well, actually, it's doing a bunch of stuff. But what's your take on that, Jink?
All right, so first of all, on the joking around with stuff, Ben, we drive people crazy, and people don't like it when we joke around about them, but we do it all the time, and we do it to everybody, okay? And the audience likes serious stuff, but they like lighthearted stuff, too. And so, and Paul Krugman the other day got all hurt over Jon Stewart making fun of him, but that's just life, and everybody's going to get used to that. People make fun of us all the time. And that just rolls off my back.
No, no, I don't mind you making fun of me. I mean, I'm a funny guy as well. I think you're a funny guy. But I mean, how does that tie into the juice box stuff? Because they're really saying that on that front.
Look, you know, you mentioned three different things there. Let me take Child Protective Services. Now, this is, again, it goes to our fundamental disagreement, Alex. Like, if you say that Child Protective Services goes too far in some instances, I'm going to totally agree with you, and I bet you could find 5, 10, 20, 100 cases throughout the country where you say, look at this, look at this, look at this. Now, if you think Child Protection Services is some sort of conspiracy where they're all coordinating with one another to take people's kids, that's where I totally disagree with you. I got a neighbor who's in that. My wife used to be in that. There's no conspiracy. They're trying to do the best they can, and a lot of times people screw up. That's it.
Well, let me add my point. Half of CPS, roughly, about 54% nationally, people can look these numbers up, turns over. Because people get in it for the right reasons, and it's so bad, most people quit. Sounds like your wife did. I know there's about 50% or more that are good people. But you are five times more likely, according to the Justice Department, even Time Magazine's covered this, to be abused in government custody, CPS, than you are in anybody else's custody. They put the average foster child on 7 psychotropics. 67% are on psychotropics. I mean, it is a mill.
But Alex, that's not a conspiracy. Like, so they overprescribe. I agree with you. And if you're talking about, hey, there's a financial incentive for the drug companies to set up an incentive system so they overprescribe, I'm with you. And I think they overprescribe, right? But if it's not like the government saying, okay, ha, 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 we'll get these kids and we'll put them on psychotropic drugs and we'll you know, it doesn't work on that way. It's actually in some ways more malicious than that, in the sense that once you set up a machine to do X, it will keep doing X. And so they've turned government into a money-making machine. But so there is no smoke-filled room where CPS got together and said, let's drug up the kids. It's just, you know, if the drug companies have the financial incentive, they buy the politicians write the rules.
Okay, then my point is,
having more drugs.
Regardless, then, it's going on, we should stand up and say it's wrong. But the Democrats generally are pro-government, and so, oh, no, let's not criticize the government, let's just let it continue on. The Republicans are pro-government to their buddies, they don't want their stuff cut either, and all I'm saying is, like Nixon said, it is a big out-of-control beast. It is an out-of-control machine that nobody can control, except the establishment on top is trying to ride the beast, and we're being trampled under it.
Yeah, and look, when people ask, is government too big, too small, that's my favorite question, because it makes no sense. It's like saying, all right, how big a pipe do you need? Well, I don't know. What's the job we're doing? Are we carrying oil? Are we carrying a tiny amount of water? What do you mean, well, how big is the pipe you want, right? So it depends on the job that the government is doing. So is the government too large when it has this enormously bloated Defense Department that it starts aggressive wars? Hell yeah, it's too large. Is it too large when it gets into our private lives? In my case, I think, you know, I'm pro-choice. I think them getting between us and our doctor is way too large. You know, and so you can list a dozen ways that it's too large. You can also list a dozen ways that I think it's too small. Like, for example, the whole reason why I'm not a small-time olive picker in the middle of southeastern Turkey is because the Turkish government allowed my dad to get a free education because he scored high on an entrance exam. That's the government saying, hey, we're going to give everybody an opportunity, whether they're poor.
They do that to find, under the eugenics model, and I'm not judging Turkey's models. I'm not enough of an expert on it, you know, 60 years ago or whatever. Though I know quite a bit more than the general public does about the history of it. My issue is they do that to pick and find the brains to make sure that there aren't what they call wild sons or bad sons out there that grow up and get power outside of the power structure. Let's expand on this. Golfer Phil Mickelson pays over 63-64% in federal and just state income tax. If you add in the property tax and all the other taxes, it's over about 74% for somebody making as much money as he does.
I don't believe that.
Well, I mean, are you?
I don't think that's accurate at all.
I pay close to 60% in taxes.
Yeah, I mean, look, if you're adding everything, if you're adding local taxes, property taxes, which is a whole different ballgame, sales tax, you might get to 60%. But if you've got the 60%, that means you're making a hell of a good living. I mean, I got friends making millions of dollars, and they say that in the end, and they live in New York, which is heavily taxed, they're at around 50%.
Yeah, worse than that. Are you kidding? In New York?
You should pay 50%.
Hey, Obama just hired that French researcher, top economist lady, to help tune international economics with the U.S. That woman is somebody pushing for the 75% taxes on top of everything you make above 75%. I mean, the government needs 90%. France is the model. Feudal serfs only paid 10% in ancient Europe.
But, Alex, if you remember the golden years of America from, you know, about 1945 to 1980, when our economy did the best, more accurately probably 45 to 75, the tax rate was anywhere between 71 to 94%.
But the loopholes were so big, that's not actually the case. Kennedy cut some of the highest tax rates by 35%, the median tax income by 50%, tax receipts doubled. Why does government want higher taxes when they know generally tax cuts increases revenue, or do you disagree with that?
I do disagree with that. So when Kennedy cut taxes, they were still above 70%. And remember, that's for the highest marginal tax rate. So that's for every dollar above whatever the threshold is, right? So if Kennedy doubled the revenue and he was at 70% for the highest marginal tax rate, well, that's not so bad. Now, look, I think that's too high. For my personal taste, I think, and that's why my family supported Reagan when we first came here, because at that time, if you remember, before Reagan, the highest marginal tax rate was 70%. I thought that was outrageously high. But now we've got it to a point where it's far too low. Look, when Clinton raised the taxes to 39% for the top rate, what happened? The economy boomed. We added 23 million jobs. Bush cut it. Also, Obama cut it. And what happened? We lost jobs. We didn't gain jobs.
Wait a minute. Obama promised not to increase payroll tax, and he increased it on 77% of Americans. People making $30,000 got an increase, 3.8%? There's all sorts of taxes being increased. You know, here's my big issue with taxes. If you had an angel, a good angel, distributing it all, it would still make people slaves in the final equation and not make you independent and make you domesticated. The establishment, the richest people in the world, come and lobby for higher taxes because they know they're always going to have loopholes and are exempt. Warren Buffett and people like that. And then they end up getting the money in banker bailouts and corporate welfare. They're trying to shut down the Small Business Association in the federal government administration. They take our tax money and then they give it back to select insiders. I mean, that's what's going on here.
Some of that is true. For example, the role of how big business crushes small business is one of the most underreported stories in the country because they want a competitive advantage, so they, you know, set the rules in the government so that it is to their advantage and against small businesses. But no, overall, most of the rich don't want higher taxes at all. Warren Buffett is someone that everybody talks about because he's such an exception. Well, all the hedge fund guys, the private equity guys on Wall Street cry bloody murder if you touch their taxes by 1%, and they're paying 15%, which is outrageously low.
Yeah, they wrote the laws. They wrote the laws. And it's the very same mega banks and Wall Street people that fund the Democrats and Republicans. I mean, look at Romney. He was funded by the exact same groups, except for the Koch brothers, so you guys always use them all day. But the point is that now they flipped against the Republicans. I mean, it's just such a cynical game, and any big government is going to create that trough for the fraud, waste, and abuse to take place.
That's totally true. And the Democrats and Republicans are playing us all day long, and Fox News and MSNBC set up this false debate, this false drama. Oh, my God, is it going to be the Democrats? Is it going to be the Republicans? What difference does it make? Obama renewed. In fact, he didn't just renew. He made the Bush tax cuts permanent for 99% of Americans. So that's the 1% change we voted for. I mean, look, you're upset. If you're a progressive, we're 10 times more upset because they never do anything progressive. Never. Why? Because Wall Street and the guys who pay the politicians aren't progressive at all. They're massively conservative.
No, they're selective. They selectively enforce it on the general public, and then they're exempt from it all. So cynical with Bill Gates and all them up there talking about, oh, raise taxes, rich people don't pay enough, knowing it's all written where they can be tax-free in their tax-free foundations.
Alex, let me ask you a more fundamental question. And I always wonder this about libertarians. So how much government do you believe in? So, I mean, you got to have some government, right? You got to have police, firemen, teachers, et cetera. So we obviously have to have some taxes to support that government. So what do you think is an ideal tax rate, and how much government would you want?
Well, that is a huge discussion, incredibly complex, because like Ron Paul has stated, we've gotten so domesticated, it'll take 50 years to even wean off this. But if we don't turn the ship around and start going back, at least in a partially different direction, we know it's all going bankrupt and going to collapse, and then there'll be nothing, Jink.
Yeah, but it isn't going to collapse because of these things. The main reason that it's going to collapse is because we allow the banks to do unlimited gambling, and unfortunately they control such a...
And then government backs and guarantees it. Government then backs and signs us onto it.
No, look, again, that's our fundamental agreement. They've captured the government. And J.P. Morgan alone, and this is in an Atlantic article you can read. Well, it's public information you can see anywhere. Trades $74 trillion worth of derivatives. Now, that doesn't mean they're risking $74 trillion, but it does mean that is the amount of trading they're doing. So any slight error is going to lead to enormous, uncontrollable losses. And any gambler will tell you, if you take enough risk, at some point you're going to blow it.
Yeah.
And these guys are definitely going to blow it. $74 trillion is five times the size of the U.S. economy, and that's just one bank.
By the way, you know worldwide, it's estimated by the Washington Post to be 1.5 quadrille.
Yeah, it's insanity. So that's going to blow up. It's going to take the whole world economy down with it. What I'm afraid of is that people are going to take that and then misinterpret what happened there. The answer in that case, Alex, isn't less government. The answer is more regulation, more honest government.
Yeah, after the bankers have collapsed and taken everything over, they shut the game down so nobody else can even basically do anything. See, that's the problem. They know this is going to screw up. They signed us onto it. Then they implode it. Then they pose as saviors. Then they bring government in. We go from 25 million on food stamps to 50 million to 100 million, and then we're all completely domesticated, and the social engineers win. Let me shift gears with you. General Boykin, former head of Special Forces Command, is in CNS News today talking about how there's evidence that our government's arming al-Qaeda. Well, come on. That's in the New York Times even. Against Libya, in Benghazi, now in Syria. They're doing horrible things. They're making sure the Arab Spring doesn't become something good. They're making sure that Saudi Arabia runs it. Where you're from, Turkey, so I know you have knowledge about this, is helping bring them in with the U.S. and NATO. And I'm not saying Assad's a good guy, but compared to al-Qaeda, he's a wonderful guy. And they are killing Christians. They are killing Alawite minority Muslims. It is unprecedented. Obama, it was called peace bombs when we did Libya. I mean, what is your take on where this is going, where the TSA wants to look for bin Laden in my underwear and in my wife's brassiere and in my daughter's underwear, my son's underwear, But then the government is openly funding, and it's CFR admits those groups are led by Al-Qaeda. I mean, what about that? I mean, should we give Obama another peace prize? How about 10 more?
All right. I'm really conflicted on this one. I'm not conflicted on his peace prize. That was insanity. He hadn't even done anything yet, and once he did something, we found out he wasn't altogether that interested in peace. But look, when I see Gaddafi oppressing and killing and butchering his own people, and I see it with Assad, I want to do something about it. But doing something is a really hard question. What are you supposed to do? And I totally understand that the more we get involved, and I think here Ron Paul makes a lot of good points, the more blowback we get, and we constantly seem to be funding and training the wrong people. Look at what happened in Mali. We train some of the guys in Libya. They go over to Mali, and then they turn on.
Oh, it's all an accident. Then we got to invade. Oh, we got to invade all Africa with AFRICOM now. I said 4 years ago in Obama deception they'd use Al-Qaeda to invade those very countries and do this. You know how I knew? There's Pentagon public white papers. They think we're so – see, Cenk, I've got West Point documents from 4 years ago and last year and now this year where they're training to take on gun owners and take our guns. That's why I know, Cenk, they're coming because I have the Army manuals. I have the Army sources. Do you understand what's going to happen when they come for the guns, bro?
Okay. I keep going back to it is totally unnecessary. What they would do if they came for guns is they would, stir up the biggest S storm you ever seen.
They're trying right now.
Why would they bother doing that when they've already got the whole system on lockdown? I mean,
they're not. No, you don't know about the Mao said political power grows out of the barrel of a gun. Our forefounders knew that as well. They just wanted the people to have the power. Don't you get that, man? Don't you trust yourself?
I mean, Alex, think about what kind of... Look, you can't do through guns and violence if you're going to fight back against the government. You've got to do it the King way, the Gandhi way, because if you try to outgun them... You know what Gandhi said? He said, part of the reason we didn't use guns is because we didn't have them. Now, you would take that as an example for your side. I actually say, well, of course Gandhi was never going to... beat the British with weapons, they had so many more weapons. The way you beat them is by other means. And so if you do it democratically, you do it politically, and you get people riled up and you say,
Cenk, how much military history have you studied? Listen, we couldn't, our entire military couldn't defeat the North Vietnamese because they had a will to fight. The rifleman is the power. Okay, there are 160 million gun owners plus in this
Alex,
country.
You're going to give them an excuse to kill you. Okay, I mean, the minute you pick up a gun, they're going to feel absolutely justified striking back.
Cenk, there you go, I'm not picking up a gun. I don't want to have a physical conflict. They are preparing to try to confiscate the guns and demonize gun owners. It's in the Homeland Security documents that we broke 3.5 years ago. They want to start a civil war and then call us terrorists. And you'll be like, well, they killed Ron Paul and Alex Jones. They had to. They were going to lead a revolution. See how that spinning works? I want to give you some statistics when we come back. I can't wait to have you back on Skype. I saw how great your Skype looked before it failed there in your Young Turk studio, theyoungturks.com. I'm Alex Jones. All right, we got him 5 minutes into the next hour, and he promises after he does his big D.C. trip next month, he'll come back with us in March or so via video Skype. Cenk Uygur. And I got to say, I don't agree with a lot of stuff he says, but he says it real slick the way he sells it. Very funny. I'm a fan of a lot of the stuff they cover. He covers things that the other Democrats and liberals won't cover because they're really a bunch of authoritarian scum, just like most of the Republican leadership. But he joins us. But I brought Melissa Melton in because she was going to be on earlier today, but then I ran out of time. And Melissa, we've got FBI statistics from FBI.gov for TV viewers. We're going to be putting these up on screen for radio listeners. The video will be posted later today at Infowars.com. Go over these statistics for Cenk so he can respond.
Well, the situation is that we have a lot of media and politicians that are throwing out statistics and they don't cite their sources. So we don't know if those are coming from think tanks or special interest groups. This is from the FBI.gov. They collect this data from 18,000 law enforcement agencies across the country every year.
And private groups have studied it. Some of the most accurate numbers out there.
That's what they
We're not usually fans of government numbers, but...
But this is what we have that's the most consistent over the years. And using basic calculations for percentages, you can see by their own data that goes back to 1992, the uniform Uniform Crime Report shows violent crime has been cut in half since 1992. And if you take the 1992 violent crime rate per 100,000 people of 757.7, you subtract the 2011 violent crime rate of 386.3, you get 371.4. If you divide this by the original 1992 rate, you get 0.4902, multiply that out, and you're going to have a decrease right there of 49.02% in violent crime between 1992 and 2011. And the murder rate shows the same decrease as well, actually. If we can go to that.
So people think it's the end of the world and everybody's dying. But the truth is, the only thing going up is mass school shootings, and that's 88 a year. About half of those gangbangers killing each other. It's still a bad thing. But, I mean, Biden going riddled with holes, beautiful children. I mean, it's so exploitive. We're going to go to more numbers here in a moment. Hit pause on that. But, Jink, I mean, respond. I mean, almost a 50% cut as more guns get bought, as the criminals get scared in the last 20 years.
So, Alex, there's about 12 different possibilities as to why the crime rate started going down in the early 1990s. I read a brilliant article in Mother Jones about this, and we had Kevin Drum on the show to talk about it. And I was really skeptical about it, but it turns out the one thing that correlates with crime increases and decreases
is lead.
Is lead, okay. And so the leaded gasoline really screwed this country up in a big, big way. Now, to me, I get that the crime rate is going down, and that's a terrific thing. And again, there's a lot of
factors. Is that why we all beat the hell out of each other in the 80s?
I think so.
I'm sorry.
I thought that was aspartame.
Anyway, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
the problem with the guns isn't necessarily the crime rate as much as it is gun homicides and, of course, these massacres. And then, you know, you look at the international rates and, you know, you've got Japan, you've got Australia, and, you know, they've passed their ban in Australia in 96. They haven't had a single massacre since. In Japan.
Oh, yeah. Now they're trying to take the bolt action guns. Now they're okay, but let me throw this at you. Long after leaded gas was out, they did concealed carry, and that's when the real drop started. So it's not the lead. That's a small part. I agree. I've seen the studies. That's a small part from the complete rage of the 70s and 80s. Okay, but in the 90s, it's concealed carry, more guns, less crime. You can use Japan, where nobody robs each other when there's a tsunami, and say, look, they have lower crime. I mean, it's a different culture,
no,
is my point.
But look at Japan. No, let's look at Japan for one second. They have in the ballpark of 2 to 10 gun homicides over the last 6 years or so, okay, per year, which is and Japan is a smaller country than us, but they're a significantly larger.
And if a samurai told a villager to get on their knees because they had disrespected him and to let them cut their head off, they would not resist. That has been a programming in the culture of feudal Japan. They're great, smart people, but that's leftovers of that. The total submission.
They don't have guns, Alex. They can't kill each other with guns because they don't have them.
But they got guys that go in schools and stab people with knives.
Yes.
The government wants
and
the guns to enslave us. Stay there, back in 60 seconds.
Alex Jones.
All right, it is our final little segment with Jink Uger of TheYoungTurks.com, syndicated radio TV host and star of YouTube with their news. Pretty entertaining, but I don't agree with a lot of it. I mean, I'll say that up front because, oh, it's an accident. Oh, it's corrupt. Oh, whatever. But at least the guy is not one of these Skeletor demons like the mainline Democrats are that I've met behind the scenes. I mean, at least she'll admit that it's wrong that Obama. I mean, did you think that was sneaky how he said, don't worry, I'm going to veto NDAA so you don't have to fight it? And then he blamed the Senate, so they released the letters where his lawyers wrote it, and Obama demanded it. Then he said, don't worry, I won't sign it, and he did. I mean, it's the way Obama gets you to feel good when he walks you out behind the barn and slits your throat. I mean, it's really creepy.
There's a great show, or there was on Starz called Boss. Kelsey Grammer was the star of it. I don't agree with Kelsey's politics, but damn, he was brilliant. I thought he was the best actor on TV. And there's a great line in there about politics. They say, the donors say, we want change on the outside and continuity on the inside. And that right there is Obama in a nutshell. He sells you change, and then he just keeps the machine rolling. We give kind of wrestling nicknames to people sometimes. Obama's nickname is the establishment. And God, he does a brilliant job of pretending he's giving you historic change while he ups the ante, honestly, on the police state and the warrantless wiretapping and the NDAA. I don't know why he does it. I mean, I'm not a psychologist, but I do know he does do it.
Well, he's bought and paid for by the very same interest. I mean, we already went over that. But I would just ask you to do this, because I know you care about the children. The vaccines, in most cases, like flu, do not protect you from what it does. On the insert, it says it can kill you, give you narcolepsy, you name it. And all over the world with the meningitis and other shots they're giving kids, polio shots, it's killing them. I've got articles up at InfoWars.com right now. Will, if I send you the actual studies and reports about vaccines killing kids, will the Young Turks cover that, or would you get kicked off the Al Jazeera TV?
Well, right now we don't have any deal with Al Jazeera. I mean, I'm continuing on my old contract, and I've never been worried about getting kicked off of anything, as you might know. But on the polio stuff, will I read it? Of course. Will I cover it? I don't know. It depends on what's in it, because, you know, look, I don't know anything about it. I'm not an expert on it, but every single doctor I know says that they believe in the vaccines. They think the polio vaccine is enormously important.
Well, they've been brainwashed. They've been brainwashed by it, and they're told to do that by the medical companies they work for. I happen to know doctors that are pushed and given kickbacks for how many people they give shots. Well, in closing, tell us about YoungTurks.com and what you guys are going to be covering tonight.
So, you know, we do our live show 9 o'clock to 11 o'clock Eastern on TheYoungTurks.com. You could also see it on YouTube.com/TYT. And especially on YouTube.com/TYT, you got all the clips. So if you like a story about guns or you like a story about the NDAA, you'll be able to watch that in about 5 minutes and not necessarily have to watch the whole show. And we do all the news. So we got pop culture, we got really serious politics, foreign policy, and then we've got a network of about 20 channels on YouTube as well, so you can watch sports or any of the other topics that you like. So YouTube.com/TYT.
Yeah, you certainly pioneered things. Glenn Beck's trying to copy what I've done, but also what you've done. In closing, look, I know the New World Order is real. I've studied what they plan. It's a eugenics program, just like injecting black people with syphilis. That's the tip of the iceberg. And I'm telling you, they're evil. If you care about your children, you have children, right? If you care about your children, the GMO, the top companies are on record, it's designed to sterilize you. If you care about your kids, look into the vaccines. If you care about what's happening, I'm telling you, this is not my opinion. The reason I get so upset, Jenk, is because I know this stuff's real, and I think you might have a heart and a soul. So I'm asking you, don't sell out to the New World Order. You've shown you left MSNBC because you were against the war and stuff and the things they're doing. Go all the way. You don't need the system. Come out against the New World Order. I'm telling you, look into what I've covered. It's real.
So far, I disagree with you on that, Alex, but I'm always open to reading things.
All right, Jenk, I'll say bye to you during the break. Thank you for spending so much time with us. We're going to come back with a special report, more on those statistics on the guns. All right, if you just joined us for the last hour, we had Jenk Uygur of the Young Turks on. And I don't think he's an evil person, a bad person at heart, like a Piers Morgan. But he just makes excuses after excuses after excuses. And I was talking to Melissa Melton during the break, and we were talking about how everybody's getting these allergies, and they're getting worse and worse. People that never had them are getting them to, like, normal foods, even stuff that isn't GMO. And it's because we're being biologically manipulated. And I have more than 100 eugenics books written by the top scientists, the heads of IBM, the White House science czar, how they would engineer this in the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. And we're going to get into some gun statistics here as we go into the fourth hour of Overdrive with Melissa Melton. But you were telling me a story, and I said, well, can you tell that story on air? And you said, yes, you would. You had to take your son to the emergency room last night. And I'm telling Jenk, I'm going, listen, don't give your kids vaccines. I'd like to send you the inserts. And listen, this GMO is really designed. And he's like, I don't believe they want to do that to me. I'm like, what about black men and syphilis? What about the atomic soldiers? They're just not listening, okay? There's a global scientific dictatorship. It's a plan. And 99% of people are not in on it. It's a very small technocratic group. But just like they had in the Times of London, Bill Gates, Oprah Winfrey, Warren Buffett, Soros, about 30 of them met at Rockefeller University, quote, secret meeting to discuss global government to reduce our population. That it's always the same. I mean, when I say I've read 100 books, okay, I'm not exaggerating. 100 books they've written, it's more than 100, where they admit their global government plan, where they admit they're killing us. Cancer is, I mean, that Miss America contestant's having both her breasts removed, and She's wondering why her mother and all her family's dying of breast cancer. Why is breast cancer up 3,000-something%? Why is the U.S. leading it worldwide in the increase? There's never a discussion of why is it exploding? Why is it exploding? Why are all these other autism, all these other cancers? Why? I mean, you give your kid a vaccine, they have a convulsion right there. Now the doctors are taught, this is in the news, to say, that's normal to have a convulsion. Really? And your two-year-old never talks again? Now, and again, it's around 18 months to 2 years when they all build up the 50-something vaccines. Now it's going to be 100. And then 200 they're talking about by age two. And yeah, let's turn her mic on. Go ahead and say what you said again.
The U.S. has the most aggressive vaccine schedule in the world. It's unprecedented. We have so many vaccines that are given, and it is amazing. I think it's like 69 by 18 that you're supposed to take now.
50-something by two.
Yeah, and it just keeps going up. So, and they just keep adding more.
And Bill Gates is funding, putting it in the food, pears and bananas, where you're going to take, and mosquitoes that come bite you. You don't have a choice. And Bill Gates says.
He even has a clothing thing now that's going to have nanotech in it that's going to dispense medication.
Oh, that doesn't sound like it's dangerous.
No, that sounds great.
No, everything's fine. There's not a plan. You know, the globalists just took over and are launching drones. They admit humans won't even be in the equation soon, only the elite. Let's build giant robot armies for eugenics-based elite.
That sounds wonderful, yes. And then we'll all wear their medication.
Tell folks what happened to your son?
My ex decided to take him to a well-known fast food restaurant and get him some...
Well, say the name.
Burger King. It was Burger King, and get him some onion rings. And within probably 20 minutes of eating these onion rings, his whole body just welled up with huge rashes and blisters. And he had to go to the emergency room because his eyes were swelling shut.
Yeah, a couple of years ago, we'd be on a road trip. And, you know, now we always pack all our food, period. Period. And find out where, you know, at least semi-organic store is somewhere around there. Or we pack it all on a road trip. And because every time I give in, all right, I guess we'll pull into one of the big names, my children get sick and act like demons. Mm-hmm. And the thing is, it's been shown to be addictive because McDonald's and others, by law, they call it an additive. It has silicone in a lot of the frying agents.
It does.
I mean, silicone.
Silicone, and then high fructose corn syrup and everything, too. And it's just the whole combination of all those chemicals all at once hitting a small child. It's just amazing. But, yeah, I've never, even when we've ever gone there, I mean, we eat it. We always feel crappy, like you said. But this is the first time this has ever happened, and we will not be eating there ever again. I mean, it was scary. It really scared me. They thought his throat might swell shut. They had to give him two medications.
And the hospital said it was an allergic reaction.
They said it was an allergic reaction. And that was the only thing that he'd ingested or anything.
And again, 20 years ago, there might have been one or two food allergies. Now it's hundreds of things. Eat a mango, die.
One in five Americans are allergic to wheat. They have wheat gluten issues now.
And again, didn't used to be the case. No. My grandmother, almost 90, never had allergies, has horrible ones, always lived here. It's everybody I know. I mean, listen, I've been exercising. I've been eating almost no GMO, really working hard to do it, except when I'm on the road, then it's hard. It's a habit. I have been swimming 2 miles a day back when I could still go swim before it was too cold, jogging, hiking, climbing mountains. My muscles get bigger and stuff, but I've got allergies now to cedar where I may have to leave in the winter and go remote do the show from another city. I mean, I'm actually looking at it. And nothing will get rid of it. I just gnash my teeth together. I'm so angry about it.
So bad.
I mean, this whole thing is out of control, Melissa.
Well, and then when you go, you have all these random symptoms, and they want to give you more and more medications and tell you you have more and more disorders and not tell you what it actually is.
So well, I mean, the doctors don't know. They're not specialists, but the endocrinologist, the allergist, the scientists that study the brain blood barrier, Dr. Blaylock, all of them will tell you this stuff is killing us. I mean, listen. Take all the different BT varieties of corn and stuff. There's a bunch of companies put it out, not just Monsanto. It all is designed where when bugs eat it, they die.
They die.
But they say, but it's safe for you to, excuse me. And they go, well, it's natural. They took a fungus, or in one case, a bacteria, and soup it up thousands of times, the poisonous bacteria or fungus, and then, it's two different varieties, and then we're supposed to eat that. Everything's fine. Don't matter all the bowel diseases are exploding. Doesn't matter your IQs are dropping. Doesn't matter you're getting cancer. Doesn't matter in the studies that killed all the monkeys and rats. Everything's fine, Melissa. Everything's okay. Tune into the Young Turks, man. The government loves us.
Yeah, why wouldn't you want to eat a food that produces its own pesticide? That sounds great. It's healthy for everyone. I actually read one of the people from the American Academy of Pediatrics said that there's no long-term study to show that eating less pesticide is healthier for you. So if there's not a long-term study to tell you that it's bad for you, then that means it must be good for you.
And they don't do the human studies. But then they do the monkeys, the guinea pigs, the rats, the mice. Within three generations, with multiple new GMO potatoes, you name it, the rats are almost all sterile or mentally retarded or dead or have giant cancers or no genitals or genitals on their head. Exactly. I mean, it is stuff you can't, it is, and it's all, but all these companies, Monsanto on the board of McDonald's, tied into Bill and Melinda Gates, mm-hmm. Bill Gates bought into Monsanto, and then you go track the founders and the heads, all eugenicists, all going and giving speeches how they want to kill us.
Exactly.
Bill Gates gets up at TED TV. We've got to lower this H2O equation from the humans down to zero. That means zero this. Show zero humans, and the whole crowd laughs and gets off. Ha, 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 ha. Knowing they're in on the joke. That thrills them as little control freaks because they don't like going to the Grand Canyon and seeing you. See, right there on screen. Now the number's up to 80. European children develop narcolepsy after receiving H1N1 vaccine. And then you go back. Boom, Bill Gates, it was 60-something thousand in India got sterilized. 50 African children paralyzed after receiving Bill Gates' backed meningitis vaccine. Oh, but everything's fine. Everything's good. Isn't that just precious, Melissa?
Yeah, and when you look into his foundation, they own stock in all the companies, Monsanto, McDonald's, Burger King. I mean, he owns.
And then he owns stock in the pioneering companies to treat autism and treat gut disorders. So yes. They hit it on both sides. They're going to suck the money out of you while you're debilitated and tortured. See, they don't want to just kill you. It's important to watch humanity mutate and die and be in pain. Because, I mean, that's why Joe Biden talks about those beautiful children riddled with holes. Oh, those are, I mean, have you seen that where he's like obviously getting off on it? I mean, anyone could look and go, perv, perv, perv. No. If I saw him at a park, I would creep away from him.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to go down a dark alley with that guy. I haven't seen that particular clip, but I can barely watch it. I mean, it's so hard to even see.
You guys have the Joe Biden I sent you? Cue it up. This is just part of it.
All right.
And we're going to go to break and cover the statistics in the 5 minutes after that. You know, we were giving those statistics. Most of the drop was not in the 80s.
No, it's consistently over the last 20 years.
Yeah, and they phased the lead out starting like 180 to 86 or so.
I read the lead study, yeah, but that can't be accounted for it just continually dropping for the last 20 years.
It accelerated the last 9 with the proliferation of concealed carry. And they have the local, you took stats in college.
Yeah, I mean, to say that that's all it is just, I think there's no way you can do that when you look at the whole big picture of all of this.
Well, they can't stand it. They're like, look at the children. Like Stalin said, one person dies, it's a tragedy. A million die or 10,000 die, different quote. It's statistics. They know that. I mean, they got drones murdering, blowing kids' lower mandibles off, Hellraiser type stuff. It's all cute and funny. But then, oh, the children, give us your guns. It's for them. Obama, I'll get the guns for you. The little kid high-five me. Yeah. I mean, the exploitiveness of it.
Well, he's killing hundreds of kids in other countries. That's fine. No one cares about that.
Do we have the perv clip? Okay, play the perv. Here's the perv at different meetings.
There's nothing that has gone to the heart of the matter more than the visual image people have of
those secure
kids riddled. Not shot in the straight line. Riddled. Huh. Riddled.
And one of the guys in that meeting's son planned a mass shooting that local cops stopped. See how this works?
Riddled with bullets.
It's like he's salivating over the word riddled.
Riddled. He goes, no, he has that look.
Riddled.
He goes, riddled. He barely moves his mouth. He goes, riddled.
Like
bullets.
He's about to start.
Riddled.
Oh, that's gross. Yeah.
We're going to riddle you once we get him.
That's the kind of person you
get. Yeah, cranking back up. Have you heard all the clips of Piers Morgan talking about killing people?
Yes.
Riddled. 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 But riddled. Kids riddled. But riddled.
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 That's the kind of person you get up on if you're sitting next to you on a bus and
move. Look at the guy next to him. These are government control freak pervs.
Oh,
by pervs, they want to pervert liberty.
Riddled.
Look at that perv smacking his lips next to him.
Riddled. Yes.
You want to hang out with that guy, Melissa?
Oh, God.
I'm so sick of these people.
Of that guy.
It's like General Boykin scared of him. I'm just way past it. You guys don't control me. I don't care what you do. I'm going to make sure you go down with me. How's that sound? All right, that's enough of pervo. All right,
I'm horrified.
Did you see him during the speech with Obama last week? The salivating
yes,
and the
I
he
did.
Kept fighting the smile, going.
Yeah, no, it was pretty disgusting. It was really hard to stomach.
Yeah, I got to feed the trolls here on air when I do these little pieces. They take it out of context. They've got it clipped together and dubbed my voice saying racist stuff too.
Oh, wonderful!
But it doesn't. All it does is discredit them.
Basically, it's a good way to spend your time.
Hey, good for them.
Yay!
They're going to die of cancer early, too.
They probably will.
When they beg, retching their guts out, about to take the all-express elevator straight to hell, where the devil and all his angels are waiting to roll with your soul like a millstone and take you right to the center of the frozen lake in the ninth circle. Gun statistics.
If you've ever wanted one of our best-selling generators, but we're waiting...
Now, I want to go over these gun statistics with Melissa Melton here from FBI.gov. I've talked a lot about these. I just looked at some of the statistics. 21% drop in violent crime in the last 7 years. And then I saw Fox say 49, but they didn't give the actual proof. I went and looked it up. They were being accurate. It's 49-plus percent since 1991. Melissa Melton's here to cover that. Then I'll hit a few of the headlines up at InfoWars.com. For TV viewers, we're putting graphics up showing from FBI.gov, and then we break down the numbers. And again, this is what you went to college for, along with journalism, so you've been helping us crack these numbers, but anybody can go check them for themselves. And then some will say, I thought you don't like government numbers. We know which ones are fake from economists and others, like the unemployment numbers or numbers on inflation. They used to be accurate 20 years ago, and they've gotten worse and worse, and we know how they cook them. The crime statistics are very accurate because they're compiled locally. And then they're cross-referenced by a lot of different universities and others. But the uniform crime statistics, go over these for people.
Well, these statistics come from 18,000 law enforcement agencies across the whole country. And you're talking city, college, county, state, tribal, federal agencies all over. So 18,000, they compile this data every single year. And they've been putting it up.
And it's from court records. It's all filed, the arrest, the what was reported.
They report it to the FBI through their reporting system that they've had for many decades.
And so you got 18,000 groups that can cross-check their info. It's been found to be some of the most accurate numbers out there.
This is what everybody uses. This is our most consistent crime data that we have in this country. It comes from these numbers.
In fact, if they do anything, they've been caught inflating it to get money. So it's probably even lower than what they're saying, but go over it.
Well, okay, so what they have up right now is from 1992, and if you use the basic calculation for percentages, you'll see that violent crime, we'll start with that, has been cut in half since 1992. The 1992 violent crime rate per 100,000 people was 757.7. If you subtract the 2011 violent crime rate, that's 386.3. You get 371.4. You divide this by your original 1992 rate, that gives you 0.4902. Multiply that out to find your percentage, and you're going to have a decrease of 49.02% in violent crime between 1992 and 2011.
Incredible.
And the murder rate shows actually the same decrease from 1992 to 2011. In 1992, the rate was 9.3. In 2011, it fell to 4.7. If you subtract, you get 4.6. Divide that by your 1992 base rate, and again, you get a 49% decrease in murder rates in this country from 1992 to 2011. So it's cut in half. We have half. And actually, all the major crime categories that the FBI does collects all this data for have dropped significantly between 1992 and 2011. As you can see here, I've got all the numbers up there. Every single one of those numbers has dropped. Every single one.
Every one. The only crime statistics, we shoot another report on this, is the petty crime. Because criminals are afraid to home invade, carjack now, or knock a woman on the head. I mean, that was just prolific decades ago because they're scared of getting blown away. Now, you look at what you ought to do in the next few days is do this versus British crime rates. They've got those numbers. Just the muggings, the stabbings are just off the charts.
They have a much higher rate of rape there than we do here also. Their rape is going off the charts. I mean, a lot of their stuff, their violent crime is going off the charts. It's much higher.
They estimate in many states a third of women are packing heat in their purse. You're going to try to rape her in the parking garage.
Well, they've calling Britain the violent crime capital of the UK. Because it's higher. Their rates are higher for violent crime than, I believe, Australia, South Africa, here, and Canada.
So. Did we cover all the statistics?
Yeah, that's all the graphics that I have here, all these different statistics. But, all of these are consistently down. Every single thing is consistently down. Anybody can go. They can get these reports. They can see. They've put them up every year for the last 20 years. So they can go to the FBI. They can download all of it. They can download it for their state. They can look at all of this different information right down.
And then you can double check. Let's say you live in Fresno, California, or let's say you live in
look at your specific city and you can
Clearwater, Florida. You can go check those numbers. Exactly. Check it with the newspaper.
For the last 20 years you can look at that. And they do this every single year. And like I said, this is used every time a criminal justice study is done, it's pretty much used. Every class I had in grad school, we use this data because this is the most consistent data that we have. And some people like to detract and argue about this data and say, well, crime is underreported, but if anything, I would say this is the...
It was underreported then. I mean, there are obviously some unreported crimes, but that's a constant in the pool. A lot of statistics I've read have shown it's more reported now because it's easier to report because the internet...
to report.
And they let you do it with anonymity, which is unconstitutional. In the past, you had to go face your accuser.
Right. And over the years, the FBI has made their system of reporting from these local agencies easier for them to report their data as well and have a much more consistent...
Well, everybody knows there's less crime. When I was growing up in Dallas... I remember some weeks when there were like 60-something dead. And because, you know, in the 60s and 70s, everything got real anti-gun, and gun ownership went way down. They were winning their war. Everybody was getting rid of their guns. Crime exploded all over, but then guns came back, and criminals are scared. But any police will tell you that. I mean, look, you home invade in Texas, you're probably going to die.
Yeah, I mean, I read a statistic today, and I didn't bring this one in here with me, but... Assault weapons are only used in, 0.6% of all murders?
I know, and I kept trying to tell Piers Morgan, hey, these aren't even used. You're using this as just a tiny example to blow it up, to pull on people's heartstrings. And he's like, how many murders in England with guns? And I'm like, how many murders with knives?
And he didn't even cite his sources. And then Ben Swan went on and did a report to show all of his sources were incorrect anyway.
Yeah, it was a lot higher in England than what he said. Great job.
We're on the march. The Empire.